Good morning.
Good morning. Alright, sorry. No, may report ako na post-up ko na mga campaign na people ni Pacquiao. They are willing to support a parliamentary effort to
okay, thank you.
To cure corruption. Pero sabi nila, hindi mo na magsalita si Pacquiao tungkol doon kasi boxing mo na bukas.
Ay, oh, bukas na pala, no? Ang bakbakan, no?
Oh, magbabaksing na. So, okay. Welcome, everybody. I hope na nalate ako. Pero ano bang kailangan kong gawing co-host? Nasa ano si Mel?
Okay, so the session is in order. And for the information of everybody, I invited Papray and Dr. Sharif Albani to be our guest speaker today. And Dr. Albani said that he might be coming late. But because Captain Ray is here, so I recognize Captain Ray. And I recognize all of you, Attorney Posadas, Carlo Iway, El Ramos, Sunny Domingo, Sunny Gianni Bintusa, Michael Alunan, and Mel Lugod. Okay, Capray, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Chief Brother Bien and to Brother Hill, Attorney Robert, Sunny, Jingle, June, Al Santillan, Sir Michael Melo, and Brother Carlo. So thank you very much to this noble chamber. Based on your suggestion, Brother Bien, it's better that we discuss the proposal when all of the major groups is here already for everybody's convenience.
Okay.
And I just want to make it clear that I read both the proposal of Attorney Posadas and the one that is refined by Brother Hill and the group. And everything is in consonance with the provisions inside. So wala tayong nakikita na medyo offshoot at napakaganda ng pagkakagawa, clear and concise. At sana i-adapt ito ng ating presidente dahil ito naman talaga ang matagal na nating prayer. Just to give you a short information regarding the plan on August 26. This is an initiative done by Jojo Tejano, Professor Jojo Tejano, in coordination with his pastoral group in Manila. And we practiced that already last event in the Supreme Court when they filed the proposal letter, position paper. So nakikita natin mas maraming dadalo ngayon dahil we had a talk with Doc Iggy last night and also with our Gising Maharlika and also with KDP and some major groups that show their intent to join the event. It will be a short walk from Baclaran that will start at 1 p.m. going to Senate. And that is the place we will file our petition letter to all the senators, courtesy by the pastors of Manila and Attorney Polly and Attorney Aaron Sugilon. So it is signed by the citizen of the Philippines. Maraming pumirma. We don't know yet the exact numbers, but the numbers is already convincing. Actually, last year, as early as April, we filed the same petition letter to our Senate with the help of Attorney Ed Caballo of BARM. So we delivered the letter directly to Senator Soto's office and the same time with our ex-speaker, Congressman Alan Cayetano. But we don't know for whatever reason, they did not respond to our petition letter. So Attorney Ed Caballo made a follow-up and still the same. we got a short reply by verbal that they don't want to touch the issue regarding the pandemic or whatsoever. The very same reason that our public attorney's office had given, that they don't want to touch the issue regarding the tyranny and atrocities that we're experiencing with this present scenario. So now, it is almost 18 months that we are fighting it out with our government. Not necessarily we want the government to fail. We are finding and recommending alternative solution. That is a bank with the perspective of our noble doctors and the citizen. So the move in August 26 will be supported as well by our retired military and policemen. Those policemen that we help because they don't want also to get inoculated. And just to give a brief background regarding what Attorney Aaron did, he won almost all cases in line to this pandemic. To cite examples, there are so many deaths.
Recording in progress.
That was attributed to COVID, but the families don't want them to be cremated, their loved ones. So Attorney Aaron fight it out with the hospital, the mayor's COVID operation center, AITF, and as well as the barangay and the PNP. And they all back out. Natakot sila ng kakasuhan na sila ng Attorney Aaron. And those dead in the family were buried in normal procedure. Yung gusto ng bawat Kristiyano na mailibing sila ng normal at hindi cremated. So nanalo yan. There are also instances that there are some students that they cannot get their class card unless otherwise they are vaccinated or inoculated. So inilaban rin ito ni Attorney Aaron in the case one. The school gave the student their class cards. At meron rin tayong mga workers, laborers, mga vendors na ayaw palabasin dahil sa checkpoint during ECQ. At gamit ang grade coercion force, forms, legal forms, nakalabas sila ng kanilang community at nakapunta sila sa kanilang trabaho. At marami pang instances ng violation ng ating constitutional right ang naipanalo ni Attorney Aaron. So ang manifestation natin rito is tama yung ginagawa ng ating shadow House of Representatives, itong shadow Congress natin na the only way to regain back our freedom is to assert our right. Takot naman sila eh. Ayaw nilang, atras sila lahat. And since last year, sinasabi natin na kung mali yung pinapakipaglaban dahil natin, dahil nagkaroon ng pronouncement ang Malacanang na lahat ng mga anti-movement na nangyayari sa ngayon, isuhulihin nila. Last year pa, we are daring them to file a case against us. Pero wala naman silang ginawa. Ibig sabihin, alam nila na may mali talaga. So yun rin ang dinidiscuss natin continuously sa ating concerned doctors and citizens of the Philippines. And nagpalit na sila ng leadership ngayon. The president now is Doc Homer Lim after Doc Iggy Agbayani. And they are in the right direction. We have to have a vehicle para manalo. We are not just ranting, complaining, but we are offering a concrete solution para sa gobyerno. And the best next move actually ni Attorney Aaron and Attorney Sigulin is to file a multiple case against FDA, DOH, AITF. And if necessary, they will file a case against the president. That is fixed already. We have to practice our right. Nandiyan naniniwala tayo sa ating batas. May mga nakakausap tayong noble judges and mga lawyers. And they're ready to help Attorney Aaron and Attorney Polly. And para sa kaalaman ng lahat, filing a case against government official, it takes a lot of courage. It takes a lot of passion, dedication, and yung will natin na mabago ang lahat. Marami nang nangyayari sa atin na mga mali, marami ng mga pagnanakaw sa gobyerno, And let's face the fact that majority of us supported President Duterte to win his presidency last 2016. Karamihan sa atin, but we are not a blind follower. There are two sides of citizen that is supporting the presidency until now. Those people that voted for President Duterte, that even there is a crystal clear failure in one side of his presidency, tikit mata, tinatanggap nila ito at dinedepensahan pa nila. The other side of supporter is tayo na bilang naghihimay, nag-a-analyze at tinitingnan kung ano talaga nangyayari. It is our right to say something against the government if kailangan. Not necessarily na pag nagsabi ka ng mali sa gobyerno is anti-government ka na. Sa Pilipino kasi, pagka nagsabi ka ng mga kamalian ng gobyerno, sasabihan ka na anti-government ka. So, doon pa rin nakikita natin yung immaturity ng bawat Pilipino. Itatag ka nila na dilawan against ka sa government. Ililinya ka doon sa mga subversibong grupo. So, kailan tayo matututo bilang Pilipino na kaya tayo ganito? Kasi kahit mali, niyayakap natin, natatakot lang tayong sabihan na mali kasi ang naiboto natin. It's not the way. So yan ang ating pinapanalangin at laging pinapakiusap sa lahat ng major group. And I had a long discussion with Professor Butch Valdez last Monday. And iisa yung tinatahak ng aming kaisipan na we are after unity. We are not a perfect human being. Marami rin tayong flaws. Marami tayong pagkakamali sa buhay natin. Maraming hindi natutuwa sa ginagawa natin. Pero this is it. Kung wala tayong gagawin, sino gagawa nito? At kung hindi natin gagawin, kailan pa? And lagi nating sinasabi na sa bawat galaw natin, ng isang tinatahak natin is isang landas naman, talagang nakakatuwa at ako'y humihingi ng paumanhin minsan kapag may tumatawag sa atin at hindi tayo nakakasagot dahil we are too many conferences, mga Zoom, not only with our group, with CDC, PH, with our Gising Maharlika, with KDP, with our Alliance of COVID Resilience Philippines, also with our Muslim brothers and sisters. Yan tayo nakapokus ngayon. And to our retired military and policemen, discussing the 9 million padded voters in COMELEC, how we can dismantle the agreement between Smartmatic and the government and COMELEC. And we are trying to get the line of Mr. Andy Bautista through Ma'am Rose Palacio to get the inner depth regarding the structuring of Smartmatic. At alam naman natin na pag-aari ito ng Dominion na kumukontrol sa halos lahat ng bansa kapag ka may election. So whatever election we are dreaming of comes 2022, hanggat nandyan yung 9 million padded voters na ibinigay at iminungkahi at diniscuss ni Brother Hill, hindi nawawala sa isipan ko at saka sa puso ko hanggang ngayon. We are talking to the military regarding this. And sana mapag-usapan rin ito sa ating House of Representatives at ma-convey natin sa ating legislative body, sa Congress at saka sa Senate. Lahat sila kasi nakikinabang rito. Let's admit the fact. 9 million voters, malaking bagay yan. Kayang ipanalo ang presidente, kayang ipanalo ang congressman o kahit na sinong senador at sinong national local government official na tatakbo sa 2022. Ayaw nila itong galawin kasi nakikinabang sila at makikinabang sila. So useless ang eleksyon kapag ka nandyan pa rin yan. We have to do something. And we have to give back the control sa ating mga religious leader, military, and the common tao. Nandun ang focus natin. Sana nga walang magrehistro sa itong darating na October. Dahil same banana rin yan. Hanggang nandyan ang Dayaan, hanggang nandyan ang Smartmatic. We will have all, many of the same. Makakakuha lang tayo ng marami ng parehas na problema na kinakaharap natin. So So, yan ang mga priorities natin dapat sa ngayon. At pangalawa nga, itong sinusulong natin na malalim na discussion sa CDCPH na we are not against vaccination. Bilang OFW and ex-Navy officer, marami tayong tinanggap na bakuna sa katawan natin. But not this one, itong hurriedly made experimental dangerous foreign vaccine. Hindi, ito, isa ito doon. Alam natin na ito isa malawakang conspiracy ng mga evil elites at marami nang namatay. That is one major aspect ng focus namin nila Attorney Aaron, gathering all documented evidences na nagkaroon ng mga adverse side effects at mga namatay ng dahil sa bakuna. We will not be talking and filing petition without heavy documented evidences and live witness, mga pamilya ng namatay ng dahil sa bakuna. We will not do that. Lahat ng malalalim na ebidensya is kinakalap natin ngayon at yan ang ipepresent natin kung sakaling umaksyon ng ating Senate. If not, we will go back to our Supreme Court and file the mandamus following court stair hierarchy. So hindi naman tayo magbabypass ng ating system sa ating korte at dadaan tayo sa tamang proseso as per Attorney Polly and Attorney Aaron's lead. Marami po silang mga abogado, hindi lang naman silang dalawang mag-ina. There are lawyers in the family. Tatlong anak ni Attorney Polly are lawyers. Yung asawa niya is lawyer. Marami silang mga kamag-anak na lawyer at kaibigang mga judges and justices as well. So yun ang focus natin talaga sa ngayon. At ang ating vehicle para masabi natin na hindi nila galawin yung ayaw magpabakuna is yung ating ivermectin. Nandyan yung ating pabunan antiviral injection na nasa Indonesia na sooner or later will be given a emergency use authorization. Makakarating uli rito sa atin. Maraming mga natural cures na nandyan lang. And yan ang vehicle natin na patunay na hindi tayo mahahawahan at hindi tayo makakahawa. Yan ang ating vehicle para irespeto yung mga nagpabakuna at irespeto rin yung ayaw. So anyway, we will need only 6 months to 1 year at malalaman na kung sino yung nagsasabi ng totoo. Kapag kayo nabakunahan, karamihan sa kanila is hindi nagkasakit at hindi namatay. So tama sila. Kapag ka maraming nadisgrasya ng dahil sa bakuna, ibig sabihin tama yung sinasabi ng ating concerned doctors and citizens of the Philippines, yung sinasabi ni Dr. Jose Oclarit, nandiyan rin, nandito ngayon si Dr. Fidel Fernandez. May mga weight yung kanilang mga statement dahil sila ang expert sa field na ito. Wala sa DOH, wala sa FDA. Kung meron man, mabibilang mo. But those expert doctor scientists, mga naturopathic nating integrative doctors natin is nasa labas ng gobyerno. Dapat ito yung pinatawag nila as early as March 2020 at pinag-usapan muna bago sila gumawa ng mga action na against at nagbabiolate sa ating constitutional rights. Marami yan. Hinimay na ni Attorney Polly ang konstitusyon at nakita niya na maraming violation dito. At yung mga violation na yan, nangyari na, ginawa na nila. So hindi na nila pwedeng itanggi yan kahit sa ang korte. Ginawa na kasi nila at nangyari na at may mga pinakawala na silang mga guidelines, resolution, protocols. Yung mga yan, hindi batas yan. Above all memorandum, above all circulars, above or protocols, still, ang nasa ibabaw niyan is yung batas. At kahit nung wala pa tayong batas, yung ating inherent right to life, nangingibabaw na yan. God-given right sa atin yan. Proteksyonan ng ating buhay sa mga bagay na inaakala nating makakasama at makakamatay sa atin. Nagkaroon tayo ng konstitusyon, kahit basahin natin paulit-ulit ang konstitusyon, nangingibabaw pa rin yung ating constitutional right to life. Our right to choose, our liberty for a peaceful assembly, our right to travel, nandiyan lahat yan. And hindi nila pwedeng gawing disguise yung para masave ang life ng iba is control nila ang buhay ng lahat. So nandun tayo sa premise na yan. And I'm happy na continuous itong ating Shadow Congress. When the going gets tough, meron na tayong sasandigan. Ang mga sambayan ng Pilipino, meron ng sasandigan na shadow House of Representative at maraming sangay ng gobyerno na nabuo na, sila Brother Hill, sila Chief Bien, Lorke, Brother Bien, ng mga department shadow leaders natin and members. Ang dami na, halos kompleto na. At nabasa ko lately yung ating NAPSI. Kundi ako nagkakamali, yun yung ating National Anti-Poverty Commission, na meron na rin tayong shadow leadership and membership. So saludo talaga ako sa inyo, Chief Bien and Brother Hill. And ulitin ko, pasensya na minsan pagka hindi ako nakakasagot sa mga tawag, dahil talagang nakapokus tayo doon sa mga cases na kinukompleto natin ang dokumento, dahil mabilisan itong pag-file na ito at nationwide. Hindi lang sa Luzon na tayo magpa-file, Visayas at Mindanao meron. At ang filing natin talaga multiple filing ito ng mga violation under our constitution na nangyari na. Hindi nila ito pwedeng ipagkaila, at hindi mahihirapan ang mga judges natin na ihimayin ito at mag-decide sila. Anyway, this cases is filed on behalf of the citizen of the Philippines. Hindi lang ito bang sa isang individual na nakaranas ng tyranny at atrocities. So maraming salamat, Chief Bien, at hintayin natin, magtsatsaga tayong hintayin na nandito yung marami bago natin i-plus sa screen yung propose natin na ginawa ni joint resolution nila Attorney Robert Posadas at ni Brother Hill at ikaw rin at yung mga members ng ating Shadow House of Representatives. Maganda siya, paulit-ulit kong binasa. Kompleto ricados na siya, at maganda para makita ng ating sambayan ng Pilipino. Dahil isinere rin natin ito, yung link nito doon sa ating mga major and minor group chat na napapanood nila ngayon. At para makita nila yung nilalaman ito bago finally ma-adapt ito ng House. At ma-deliver saan man gusto natin itong ibigay, lalo na sa ating mahal na presidente. At sana aksyonan na niya yung matagal na nating pinagdarasal na revolutionary government, na ang foundation is yung mamamayang Pilipino at hindi ang foundation is yung ating gobyerno. So maraming salamat, Chief Bien.
Okay, thank you, Kapre. At narinig niyo ang initial word ni Captain Ray Baleros. Dr. Attorney Posadas, may we hear from you?
Mr. Speaker.
Yes, go ahead.
Is the suggested proclamation by President Duterte as proposed by Gil Ramos already been read?
So we have to wait for them. So they could hear also what the word coming from you, from Gil Ramos, yeah, and from
other. Okay, then it's premature for me to speak because what I needed to do so we can make an analysis and comparison as to which one to adopt or resolve is to interpolate the suggested proclamation by Gil Ramos so we can properly and logically compare the two as to which one we should resolve. Okay, so
okay, I'll noted and that. Noted and that. And what I am intending into is that you have to plus your intended draft resolution, and the Hill also will have to plus the intended joint resolution, and then we have to analyze as to whether or not which wording has to be changed, which wording has to correct be added. Correct. And then by the group, by the decision of the group, so this could be done in a smooth academic manner.
Okay, let me be clear. My resolution was already read and interpolated, so it's already on the record. It's been interpolated and it's ready now just for viewing and presentation. What Gil Ramos has to do is to read his proclamation suggestion, so that after which we can interpolate. Mine has already been interpolated. Okay.
Okay. So I also read and reread what was being done by Professor Hill and what has been also done in your own proposal. So it seems to me that the main intent and purposes here of the joint resolution is to adopt the 1899 Constitution first. Second is to urge the president to follow the will of the sovereign people. Third is we are pushing the federal parliamentary form of government in contrast to presidential form of government, so that if ever possible, the corruption issue has to be minimized, if not to be stopped. And then the fourth is the issue in this pandemic, wherein we are not allowed to go out, or forced vaccination is been ordered by the president, which is contrary to the 1987 Constitution. So I think that four issue was mentioned in your the proposed joint resolution, and that issue was also mentioned in the proposed resolution of Professor Hill Ramos. That's why I told Mitch this morning that the only difference there is the construction of sentences and the terminology which was being used. But now let's discuss, as soon as the group is already here, let's discuss as to whether or not the main intent and purpose has been met. So let's focus to the main intent and purposes, not to the other way around or other some flowery word or whatsoever. The important there is that we could explain to the president that those are the will of the people, particularly the taking over of the public utilities, which is for the benefit of everybody. So if that could be done, then we will see what will be the outcome.
Okay, so let's wait for Mick Feliciano and the others, and for Gil Ramos to read the proclamation first.
Okay. So from Sunny Domingo, may we hear from you? Then next is Mike Alunan.
Yeah, good morning.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, good morning.
I've been following up since my son died a few weeks ago. And I'm happy with the development. Maybe I cannot comment so much yet, but I would like to have some sort of a summary or a synopsis of the status now of the group. In a level of 1 to 10, where are we and why so? And what's the latest development? And also, if I may suggest, we avoid criticizing first the government or the president of what is happening, because it doesn't seem to be a good entry point in a rational discussion for the future of our country. Maybe what we can discuss and I can offer is in the agriculture sector. It's been 50 years that we have been doing development in agriculture through extension work, through subsidy, through Masagana 99, through the APMA law, and all these things. But unfortunately, just this morning I posted that the farm family will soon die a natural death, or the family farm, when the rice tarification law, which provides a budget of $10 billion a year, is being just distributed like cookies and candies. They failed miserably in an area of development where it was most needed. And that was to come up with programs, clusters, consolidations of small farms to enable them to buy their own machinery if they do not get it for free, to enable them to harvest by the tons every day, to enable them to irrigate their farms, to enable them to send their children to school, for them to get dividends, for them to get fair share of the use of their land. Like we are offering 30% share at no expense. And to make short, what is happening now is after 2 years, there will be no subsidy again. And when there's no subsidy, they will start to borrow again. And I don't think that there's enough money to borrow around, especially when the UFW will decline as it is declining now. And it will be a vicious cycle of poverty, hunger, and restlessness. If we do not correct the system of planting, like from seasonal planting to continuous planting, requiring irrigation, and the idea of them putting their resources together, the land and labor together, which is the 50% of the production. And all they need is capital. And since no bank is willing to take the risk, it is really for the government to provide the public investment of building silo all over the country, of the highway from Tapari to Ulo, of building a dryer or redrying plants so that they do not have to dry their palay in the highway, of building their own machineries, building their own corporations, organizing their own corporations, and 100, 200, 500, 1,000 farmers incorporating themselves to produce food for what they are, either by region, by province, or by town. So I hope this will be a basic program that will be included in the new Congress, the Malolos Congress. And also, if I may suggest that if nothing happens to what we are doing now, we should refocus, have a paradigm shift on doing something where we can make use of the election for a referendum question. Like, do you want to shift to the federal government? And it can be answered with yes or no. Do you want a prime minister? It can be answered yes or no. Do you want a nominal president? It can be answered yes or no. These are the things that maybe we should discuss in trying to convert from the Cory Constitution, the American Constitution, to what we now call the Malolos Constitution. Thank you, Ben.
Thank you. At yan nga na ako, I always posted on Facebook, hindi sa pag-promote ng liquid fertilizer dahil isa ako sa distributor nito. But I encourage people to adopt agriculture program gaya ng ginawa ni President Marcos nung araw sa Masagana, Masagana 99. So, ang ani natin ay maganda at nakapag-export tayo ng mga palay. So dito sa gina-encourage ko na gagawin, if you are harvesting, let's say for example, 100 cabans. So sabi ko kahit hindi magdubli, pero kung makaharvest ikaw ng 120 to 150 cabans every crops. So nakadagdag kaysa mag-steady ka lang sa 100 caban kada harvest mo. So in addition to that, ang mga bagay-bagay na pangyayari ngayon na parang mahirap iunawain, kagaya sa mga seafarer, sa mga marino. Ngayon may threat ang mga seaman na may posibilidad na ma-blacklist tayo sa European Union. So kung ma-blacklist tayo sa European Union, ang $5.6 billion na remittance ng mga marino sa ating bansa o sa pangatulong sa ating ekonomiya, mabawasan yon. So ang disgrasya dyan, kung mag-domino effect na hindi lang sa European Union tayo pagbabawal, pero kung ibawal to sa ibang flag state, napakalaking problema sa ating bansa. So I hope that the President, we are not contesting the President, neither we are against the policy of the President. But we are urging the President to adopt the 1899 Constitution and shift to parliamentary form of government in order to risk the transparency of how to run the government and what is to be done and what is not to be done. So by that purpose, we do hope that people, because now I cannot understand as to whether or not people are still doing research or they just follow what they heard. Pero nakikita natin na kung minsan parang tumatama ang Bible na darating araw na inis na rin ang Panginoon. Sabi niya, hayaan mo na, pagalaan na lang kayo ng paalaman para magkabulbol na kayo. So nakikita ng mga tao yan na nanumuno sa ating bansa. At sa aking pananaw, para sinundan nila. Sige nga, totohanin na lang natin kasi nakasulat na yan. May kasabihan na what is written has to be done. So, but kung kontra, kung labanan natin yan, may posible na kung ano man nakasulat na yun, kung labanan natin dahil hindi maganda sa ating kabuhayan, ay may magawa tayo. Pero kung hindi tayo lalaban, wala na tayong magawa dyan. So I do hope that by doing this Shadow Congress, sooner or later, we could resolve the problem smoothly, beneficial not only for us, but for the whole Filipino citizen. Yan lang akin mag-comment. Tama.
Makapag-produce sila. Pwedeng magpalaki ng ani, gagamitin yung fertilizer mo. Pwedeng magsama-sama ang mga lahat para kung may pagkain sila, pwede silang gumawa ng kanal na palalimin ng mga kanal. Imbes na pinamimigay na pera, dapat food for work. O bibigyan sila ng 500 a day. Basta magtrabaho sila ng pag-uhukay ng kanal, palalimin ng kanal, pagandahin ng mga kanal. At pag-uwi nila, meron silang 500 na pera, pero hatiin mo yun siguro. Yung palati noon, bigas, palati noon, pera. Mga ganun sana ang nangyayari. Alam mo, kung may food for work na sa probinsya, lahat yan na sa Tiga Manila, pupunta yan sa probinsya para lang magpala. Eh, ano na lang magpala? Madali naman magpala eh. Nung estudyante kami ang nagpapalalim. Nung siltejo
na ayun.
Yung imbes na may klase kami, isa dalawang araw na punta kami sa bukid at palalimin namin yung mga irrigation canal ng mga bayan, kababayan namin bilang estudyante noon. Pagkatapos sa sunod doon, kasama naman yung mga magsasaka. Kung kami ay dalawang araw, limang araw yung magsasaka. Kung kami ay apat na araw, sampung araw yung mga magsasaka. Yan, magandang mga samahan sa agriculture yan. Pagkikitaan, at biro mo kung sa syudad naman, biro mo kung food for work yan, tingnan mo kung di malinis ang lating estero. Baka matamlan pa ng bulaklak ng bawat estero. May mag-donate lang ng semento, malining pa ang estero natin. Gaganda ang Manila sa food for work. Gaganda ang irrigation natin sa food for work. Gaganda ang mga highway natin sa food for work. Masama ba na magtanim ng mga bulaklakin sa highway natin, imbes na yung mga kawin na pag nabangga mo, patay ka. Dapat siguro, pinapaganda natin ang mga highway natin, imbes na binabakuran. Kaya ngayon, magandang nabakuran. Eh kung ako lang may permit lang, eh tamnang kulat ng munggo. Mula sa Balintawak hanggang Bagyo, bawat Taba. Side ng highway. Pero mo, kayo lang munggong yan naanihin ng tao. Kung tinamnan ng gobyerno ng munggo yan o yung may-ari ng superhighway at pabayaan nila ang tao na mag-ani ng munggo kasi yun na araw-araw pwedeng may anihin ka, ang anihin mo for example 5 kilo lang para meron kang pagkain. Ganun yun. So, babakuran mo lang yung daanan ng pan. Pero, brigada lang naman ang gagawin mo yan. Ibig sabihin, brigada ng mga mag-ani ng munggo. Para may uwi sila ng munggo. Pag wala silang makain, di magmunggo na muna sila. Yun lang ang mga siguro, habang naghihintay tayo ng mga kasama para sa Congress, kung may mga suggestion sa paggastos ng gobyerno na makinabang ang society, ang dapat idiin natin. Kaya ng question sa DOH, wala akong alam dyan. Pero kilala ko sa DA, may question sa DA, pero na-edition na uli daw yung 7 billion. Biro mo yung 7 billion na yan, ang dami ng maani na palay niya. Ang dami ng ma-consolidate, ang dami ng ma-irrigate. Yung 7 billion na yan, 7,000 hectares na rin ang pwede ma-irrigate niyan. May tractor pull na, may maintenance na, ay may rice mill na, may silo na. Biro mo bawat bayan, meron sariling korporasyon. Sila na bahala mag-import ng fertilizer nila. Ang malungkod niyan, dalawang taon na lang yung programa niyan. Pagkatapos, gutom na naman ang mga magsasaka natin. By that time, yung magsasaka natin na 67 years old na sila. Retired na sila, hindi na sila makatrabaho masyado. Yung mga anak, ayaw naman bubukid. Eh bakit ka magpapakamada sa bukid mo sa isang hektarya na minana mo? Pagkatapos magbabayad ka pa ng amelyar at saka magbabayad ka pa ng inheritance tax para mapasayo yung bukid ng tatay mo. Eh di, anong ginagawa nila? Binibenta na lang nila. O eh magbayad na lang sila ng sales tax kaysa inheritance tax. May punan pa silang iba. Hindi na sila mag-planting rice is never fun. Pero kung ma-incorporate natin yung mga 100, 200, 500, 1,000 hektarya, makinarya na ang gamit niyan, drone na ang gamit niyan. Hindi na kailangan magbabad sa tubig ang paa at kamay ng mga magsasaka natin. Tractor na ang mag-araro, tractor na rin ang harvest. Kaya drone na rin ang mag-sprayer. Hindi na mahawakan ng kamay yan. Untouched by human hands na yan. Sila naman i-maintain lang nila yung bukid nila na talagang level naman ng bukid. Tingnan nila kung saan may sakit at isumbong nila para darating yung drone, may spray yung lugar na may sakit. Kung meron 100 square meter sa 10,000 square meter, yun lang. So makatipid pa. So ibig sabihin, ang mga kabataan, babalik niyan kasi sila mag-invest pa sila sa drone nila, sila na mag-spray ng bukid ng tatay nila. O dahil sila parang farm manager na, may sweldo rin sila sa korporasyon nila. O di sila mag-farm manager nung isang hektarya nila o dalawang hektarya nila. And then yung magkakaroon niya ng surplus na 30 tons per day, kung 10 hectares a day ang tanim mo, 6 tons ang harvest mo per hectare, 60 tons a day, i-mill mo yon, 30 tons ang rice husk. Yung 30 tons rice husk, kaya na pandarin ang 1 megawatt power plant na magbigay ng 24/7 na murang elektrisidad sa 1,000 bahay, 1,000 water pump. Magkano yung elektrisidad niyan? Sa computation namin, 350 lang. Dagdagan mo na ng kita ang may-ari, yung may-ari, yung proportion mga magsasaka, at yan, dagdag kita na nila yan. Yun po lang ang akin dyan. Thank you.
Okay, sige. Salamat. At yan nga na naalala ko rin yan nung kapanahonan natin, may mga CBAC tayo. Hindi ka makagraduate kung wala kang certificate sa CBAC.
Nasibak
si Marcos. Nasibak si Marcos. Ang CBAC project niya, nasibak rin. Pati ang project ni Mildana Pabahay, nagtaka ako kung anong klase kaugali meron tayo. May anong mga pangalan ng project ni Mildana yun, nagbigay ng bahay. Aba, sinira ang bahay. Human settlement.
Kaben. May dagdag lang ako sa nabanggit ni Kasani. At same time, emphasizing what Gil Ramos, an economist who keeps on saying yung importance of yung physical real economy, no? Sa agriculture, for instance, no? Over the past many decades, malakas, madaming bulto ng budget binuhos lang sa puro trade na nawawala lang sa ano, or so like for instance irrigation, no? Sa irrigation binubuhos parate on rehabilitation, year in year out puro rehab, ilan lang yung new irrigation. Bakit? Kasi pagbago, physically makikita mo actual na ginawa, actual na simentong binuhos, actual na mabakal na ano. Pero pag rehab, pag pini-audit mo, ituturo lang na saan yung performance mo. Ayun, tuturo yung dati. So madali itago ang kupit. So in the same way, ngayong yung panahon, since last year, yung tawag nito, yung ayuda, bakit puro cash? Kasi sa cash, madali rin itago ang kupit. I'll give you an example. Yung 200,000 pesos, that is only 200 bills of 1,000 peso each. Madali ibulsa sa kanang kamay mo lang. Kanang bulsa, tama? Kasi 200 lang yan na bills na tigi 1,000. Okay. Pero yung 200,000 na yan, kung isako ng bigas yan, that's 100 sacks of 50 kilo bags of rice. Puno ang kwarto ni barangay chairman. Hindi niya maibulsa isang dang sako. Tama? So, now, kung if it is all in kind, in physical, stocks, okay, you can mobilize the urban poor, the unemployed, the displaced workers sa packing, repacking, distribution, you can even mobilize the jeepneys, the tricycle, ito yung na-displace eh. Instead na mamimigay ka ng cash kasi madali ang kupit, walang paper trail eh. No voucher, no pirma lang. At dali igawa ng pirma. Walang cheque, walang no nothing. Hindi dumadaan sa banko. And, pero kung stocks, physical, nabibilang mo. Ngayon, you can even create employment because of the mobilization of distribution, packing, etc. Hanggang detail. Pwede mo nga gawin, linggo-linggo, may pamimigay ka. Namimigay na rin lang. Diba? Ngayon, kagandahan doon, you create movement of goods from the countryside. So, mga bigas, karne, gulay, etc. Tutuwa si Kasani yan, dahil farmer leader, yun yung ano nang inainye, mga magsasaka. So, parating nangyari, whether agriculture or not, it's all financials. Walang physical ano.
Brother Mike.
Yeah.
Dahil itigil mo natin ang farming and then you proceed to your presentation.
Ah, yeah, okay, sige. Pictures na ito, no? So, it's the future that creates the present. Sabi ng mga bata, baliktad yata yan. That's impossible. How can that be done? Time machine? Ang tinuro sa atin sa eskwela, mga magulang natin, kung sino tayo ngayon, we are products of our history, our past, our parents, tradition, culture, environment, etc. Pero if you analyze carefully, all new ideas, inventions, discoveries were started by certain people who explored into the beyond, the future, into their dreams, their goals. So yung ginagawa nila ngayon are dictated yung iniisip lang into the future. So technically, it's the future that creates your present. Tama ba? You follow, no? So what these great thinkers do today are dictated by the visions, plans, and dreams of the future. So theoretically, it is the future that ironically creates the present. Okay. Parang philosophical, no? So I bring back ideas of a great man in history na naburas kasaysayan. Like for instance, si Hamilton. He is considered by some people as the man who invented America. Naging nare-revive niya because merong Broadway na ginawa, no? He was the first treasurer after the American Revolution and an intellectual who helped build America's foundation. In fact, yung Federalist Papers, 75, there are 85 of them, no? 75% noon siya nagsulat. And these are not simple essays, but treatises on banking, manufacturing, credit, governance, the American Electoral College system, etc. No? Madami, dami siyang ano. So, and significant, which I can discuss later, yung na-pick up niya yung kay Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz, whose idea of the physical economy na pinost rin ni Benjamin Franklin, no? Who was actually the brains behind the American Revolution. Benjamin Franklin, no? So the essence of physical economy, which I was discussing earlier. Okay. So, kay Hamilton, you can finance anything. any amount is easy and payable on two conditions, no? One is it must credit must be used to increase physical wealth that creates real value, and not credit spent on speculative money game like in Wall Street. Right now, 99% of credit sa US long, no, goes to Wall Street, bailout banks, and spent on the speculative investment, ano, the casino economy. And only 1% or so into the real economy that really builds industries, infrastructure, and creates jobs, solid productive jobs. So, a second condition, yeah, to think of something bigger and better into the future, because that is bigger, more than enough to pay for the present, which is the debt you create in the present. The Hamiltonian credit principle. In fact, yung concept of fractional banking, Hamiltonian, ano yan, for every $1 of capital of the banks, they lend 10 times. So the more they create deposits from savings from the public, they can lend 10 times that amount. So banks really make money. That's how the oligarchs, that's why oligarchs go into the, no. So the how Lincoln built the railway and built industries. In fact, yung sa railway alone, it cut down travel time from 6 months to 6 days. Sinasabi nga na ang civil war was because of slavery, di ba? That's baloney. It's the British Empire opposed the American Revolution because it was threatened, the American colonial trade was threatened by Lincoln's move towards industrialization and building the railway. Because when you build the railway, you trigger development internal, domestic market. So inujuk nila yung South na mag-alsa. Sinasabi nila, magkaiba kayo, loko kayo. But everyone in America was different. Hindi mo masabing iba kayo South dun sa North, no? Every community was different. They had their own ethnic communities, cultural, ano. So no one was really concerned much about slavery issue. Although Lincoln was serious about that, no? Same with Hamilton and the rest of the many of the founders. In fact, it took more than 100 years. Time ni Martin Luther, 1860s ang Civil War, 1960s kina Martin Luther, di ba, King, where slavery, yung issue ng segregation became an issue. So Americans at that time were still busy with their own ethnocentric concerns. Pero naudyok ang South na mag-alsa. And it cost 600,000 lives because the British Empire opposed yung industrialization because it threatened the maritime colonial trade. Yung maritime colonial trade is based on port. In fact, the word port nag-derive 60 to 70 words out from port. So opportunity, reports, diba, deport, import, export, rapport. So port-based ang entire economic system because maritime colonial trade. No? So any movement or towards internal industrialization, ayaw na British Empire threatened sila. That's why they inujok nila. In fact, the British Empire also created the Jesse James Brothers. You know, ang Jesse James Brothers, they were raiding train stations kasi natinamaan na yung lupa nila ng railway. So that's baloney. Lahat ng tinamaan na daanan ng railway, nagkaroon ng mga cities nag-sprout like Denver and many others, no, along the way. So, pag tinamaan yung lupa mo ng railway, tataas nga yung value ng lupa mo eh. So, anyway, so, diretso natin, no? Okay. Anong mathematical power of the resource plowback? Okay. For lack of a better term, Filipino writer Liasim Nanula simplified Hamiltonian ideas to one coherent phrase, which he calls the resource plowback strategy. No? As resources of the future are used enough, it is okay to front-load them back to the present to build back forward to the future. Resource plowback means more than investment in physical wealth. So physical ulit, no? At times it can be ironical, metaphorical, and as explained later, I can explain later don when Henry Ford used it, no? Inherently, it has social advocacy for the common good. So come to think of it, it is bringing the future back to the past, into the present, in order to build on forward, into the future. Not only for one's own self, but for the greater good, the general welfare. So, okay. Yung resource block has its roots in Earth's productivity. Ma-appreciate ni Kasa nito, no? And merong biblical roots yan, yung down to earth, ano, yung plow back. Okay. When you plow back the fields, by biblical saying, what you sow, you reap, di ba? When you plow the fields, merong principle yan, when you plow the fields twice or more, you loosen up the soil, which enhances the soil nutrient intake and growth, allows better sunlight penetration for photosynthesis. That's why you achieve higher yield. So if you believe we can raise our souls to high heavens, keep your souls down to earth. Mga ano lang to, playing with words, punning, no? Pun. I'm a pundit. Why the need for a resource plowback, no? A reason for widespread backwardness in most business of focus more on getting a share of the pie. Yung akin to, get a slice, profit making, no? Which means great. Pero ang nakaligtaan, yung how to increase the pie itself, creating more physical wealth. Back ulit tayo dun sa idea of physical economy, no? A Leibniz idea, no? Of higher productivity and outputs. Yung getting slice, kumbisan, madaming rent-seeking businesses na very extractive one way, just get a share of the pie without really plowing back to increase that pie. They don't realize but when that they can actually earn more when you plow back more. Diba? When you plow more, diba? You get more yields. In agriculture, that's how it is. No? So anyway, to appreciate it better, okay, ang banko...
5 minutes,
Yeah, yeah. Okay, ang banko, banks will lend you based on past performance, past track record, collateral with salt of your past. Pero ang Hamiltonian principles, iba. You lend against future returns, future production, puro future. See? So, appreciate it. So, okay. In-apply ni Henry Ford yung Hamiltonian principles. Okay. Ginawa niya, Henry Ford wanted to sell cars to his workers, but they could not afford. So what he did, he increased the wages from $1 to $5. Not because he was generous, he was greedy. So naging $5 siya, you compute that 5 days, 6 days a week, times 4 weeks a month, times 12 months a year, times 3 years, 5 years. He got a huge amount. Pag compute mo yung big amount na yan, lapit siya sa banko, banko, can you lend to my workers for a car financing? But I'll offer you 4 ways to save on cost. One is, don't worry about credit investigation. I'll give you folders of each of the workers. Huwag mo na isa-isang sinong qualify. Kung bahala dyan. Don't worry about guarantee fees, co-guarantors. I'll take care of that. Don't create a credit collection team to collect. Mag-bye-bye ka, mangulek ka. Ako na bahala. Salary deduction lang niya, di ba? Tapos third, apport. Huwag mo na i-retail, i-wholesale mo. So, what happened? Happy yung banko. Say, don't forecast. Happy workers, 5 times increase sweldo, happy si Henry Ford. But the oligarchs at that time didn't like ideas, Hamiltonian ideas. Kaya nga, the British Empire, inudyok magka-revolusyon, ginulo, etc. So the oligarchs didn't like it. Okay. So can we finance a project like a bus assembly plant, poultry farm, Jollibee food, etc. using principles? Ano? Ang golden rule, twisted golden rule, is he who has the gold makes the rules. Eh, Hamiltonian, kaiba eh. You can create credit, di ba? Okay, nasa transport kasi ako. So we're applying, dire-diretso ko lang ito, no? We're applying yung mga principles in our business equation. Anyway, and public transport, by the way, there's a executive order, it's called 666, ha? And it subsidizes only 5 foreign firms. That varies kasi power subsidy dito. It varies year after year. Like, ano. Yeah, okay. So, yun yung, yet, mga transport, walang, kasama pa dyan, Hanjin, Texas, and instrument. Okay, anyway. So, but public land just get crumbs. So why transport is strategically important? Transport provides the wheels of progress. Although transport is a service, it creates movement of goods and people, which are vital to the economy. So we thought all the way, it just took willpower. Yung pala, will power gulong. So where there's a will, there's a way. Okay, ito, tapos na ako. Tama na, tapos na ako.
Okay, so I'm recognizing Mike Feliciano, John...
Let's make comments.
Johnny Bintusa, and Region 8, James Gornot, and Bartolome Sagadal. So, in few moments, Dr. Albani will be arriving, and we could hear something from him in connection with our main intent and purposes, why we are doing this shadow government. And he has to explain the historical view of our Muslim brothers. And likewise, he has some idea about this 1899 constitution we want to adapt to. So for the time being that Sharif was not yet here, may we hear from Mick Feliciano? Mick, you are recognized?
Oh, hello. Good morning, yes, everyone. Oh, teka sandali. At biglang humina yung voice. Okay, magandang umaga sa inyo lahat. I'm here to represent the MCRI or Maharlika for Cultural Recovery Incorporated and also the Philippines for Visayas Federal Movement, no? Right now, we are actually moving fast with the exigency in bringing up to the president our concern. That's why we have messaged a few of the members here and also Uncle Robert Posadas about our planned unification on that would be a unification meeting, meaning we would consolidate the different movements, the different federal movements all around our country to bring up each and individual resolutions or their objectives in why they want a federalized system of government and consolidate it into one unified resolution. That would also bring us to realizing our the concerns of our Muslim brothers through the representation of Professor Noor Miswari. And he has acknowledged the efforts of the Shadow Congress and would like to meet a few of your representatives in Davao City this coming September 4 and September 5 in Davao City. No, September 4 would be a pre-conference briefing before the actual unification meeting on September 5, then after we can consolidate every individual federal movement's concerns and issues that needs to be addressed by the president, then we march on September 7 during the schedule of the meeting with Noor Miswari and the president himself in Davao City. That is already a confirmed schedule. That's why Professor Noor Miswari, through our chairman, Papa Romeo Melesio, is actually inviting all to join us there, no, to have our individual voices be heard as one. That is all, Sir Ben.
Well, I suggest that your proposal on September 4th to meet in Davao, I suggest that if ever possible, because of this ECQ and some strict regulation sa airport, pwede na mag-zoom na lang, mag-zoom kami dito sa Manila at doon lang tayo mag-exchange of ideas. That is my proposal.
Okay. I will send that over, that information to our chairman. Anyway, our secretary general will be coming in also to join us in a few minutes, so that he can directly tell our chairman about your position.
Okay, at saka hintayin natin si Professor si Dr. Albani. Dr. Albani, Sheriff Albani is the nephew of Normiswari. So he will be our guest this morning.
Okay, thank you very much.
So Ben from region Sane, are you saying something?
Yes, I would like to clarify from the previous speaker. Kung they have been a priori consultation, meaning a consultation before meeting with Norm Miswari on how Professor Miswari reacts to the shift to the Malolos Constitution. Because, you know, there's a cultural difference here. The reason why we cannot seem to really unite the Christians and the Muslims is because the Muslims were never really a part of the revolution, which is represented by the Muslim Malolos Constitution. So maybe we need to do some consultation and encouragement for them to join us. But I think there should be a post-priori promise to them, meaning before the change, there should be something that we must understand each other. And after the change to Malolos Constitution, there should be something that they can benefit from in helping us convert to the Malolos Constitution. For example, our Muslim brothers, I am from Basilan, by the way, can never accept to be called a Filipino because they really do not want to be part of the history of colonization. That's why even up to the Americans, they were never really colonized. So I think we should promise to them that if they help us here, then maybe we can work on changing the name of the country. What is in the name of the country? What is in the name anyway? Just for example, I had a worker, a reforestation worker in Mount Pinatubo before the eruption. His name in the payroll is derogatory kasi ang pangalan niya nilagay na pangalan niya ay sinungaling. So, sabi ko, anong klaseng pangalan nyo yan? Bakit yan ang pangalan mo? Ayan po ang nadat ng kong pangalan pa na. Sabi ko, hindi ka na magtrabaho sa akin kung kaya mo palitan ng pangalan mo. De, siyempre, papayag siya. O di, sabi ko, bigyan kita ng pangalan. Sadiri ni Lucano means spirit. Alam mo na, in his name alone, the change of his name, made him more comfortable. Nagiging leader pa siya ng worker group na parang nag-strike yung mga matatandang Aita, but ito eh. Siya nag-organize ng young labor to reforest the mountains. Because of his name, Sadiri, he was the spirit behind the continuation of the program na inayawan ng mga matatanda. So, you know, that's how a change of name differs from the past. So maraming country nagpalit ng pangalan from Siam to Thailand. Ano pa? Siguro alam niyo mga ibang countries. Bakit? Because that is their way out of their colonial cultural backgrounding. And that is a way to unite themselves. So,
okay, noted on that.
That will be the case, if I may just conclude. If that will be the case, we will have a Muslim group once their Bangsamoro law is perfected. They can even join the Federation of Malaysia. Why should they join the Federation of the Philippines? So maybe we should deal with them on that, on the basis of we were a free country. That's why we are proposing Republic of Malaya. We should be called Malayans, not Malaysians. Malay, iba yung Malaysian. Now, of course, we can carry result, the pride of the Malay race. Of course, they would like to promote Maharlika. Well, Maharlika seems to be a more neutral name than Philippines. So I think we should commit to these things before we can...
Okay, noted on that. Noted on that. And that is one reason now that I am inviting Dr. Albani, because he is now promoting the Maharlika. So let us hear, before we discuss all those things, we have to hear from him afterwards as to whether or not we agree or disagree. And if not, then we have to exchange ideas kung saan tayo mag-ari, magkita-kita na hindi magulo ang ating sitwasyon. Dahil nakakausap ko rin, malimit ako nung araw sa Sabah at saka sa mga kuta kinabalo na yan, ang mga Pilipino doon, mga Muslim brothers natin doon, gusto nila doon manirahan. Alam mo kung bakit ang kanilang katwiran, maganda ang magiging Pilipino sa bansa na Pilipinas. Ngunit sabi niya, ang pag-recognize sa amin doon ay alanganin. Dito sa Malaysia, para pareho ang recognition sa amin at maganda ang hanap buhay namin dito. Kaya ayaw namin bumalik doon. So yan ang mga kadahilanan kung minsan na tayo mga Pilipino hindi magkaintindihan at nakikita natin kahit sa within our family. Minsan ang anak natin hindi magsunod sa atin. So ano na lang natin yan? Inborn natin yan ng mga Pilipino. Then kung sa mga puti naman, pag edad nila 18, so wala sila pag-alam dahil bahala ka na sa buhay mo. Pero sa pagpalit ng mga pangalan na yan, dami ako, I visited more or less 148 countries around the world. Nakikita ko yung pagpalit ng mga pangalan, it does not mean na gumanda ang kanilang buhay sa kanilang bansa. Kagaya ng Myanmar ngayon, medyo nagkakagulo sila doon dahil nung araw, hindi naman yan. So, ang pagpalit ng mga pangalan ay hindi sapat ang sa akin nakikita kung paano mapaunlad ang kanilang ekonomiya, mapaunlad ang kabuhayan ng mga mamamayan. Yan ang pinaka-importante. So, although, yan nga sabi ko na we have to hear from Dr. Albani mamaya kung pagdating na niya, kasi makikita natin kung ano ang mga, kaya yung tawag natin to na joint resolution para mamuni-muni natin kung saan tayo magkita-kita sa gitna na maiwasan ang collision. Na hindi tayo mag-collide. Okay. Okay, so
yes, correct, I'm meeting correct.
Guys Region 8. Anyone from you could say something?
Ako po ay representante ng PBFM Region 8, pero ako po yung chairman ng Samar Islands, si Father Bart Sagadal po.
Okay.
Aami po ng pagkaisahan, we are so supportive of the Shadow Congress with this present effort. I think they are now gathered. I am now here in Calbayog City, but the Region 8 PBFM is having this meeting in our Region 8 office. I think somebody would be coming, but as part of the discussion, we are so willing to support, and we were discussing to formulate our resolution to in support to this shadow government. And as Chairman Mix also had mentioned, we were aware of the scheduled activity. Supposedly, we had our schedule of this coming tomorrow, 22 to 23, but it was changed to September. So as far as our group is concerned, we are with you. That's why we are continuously participating in this Shadow Congress discussion. Thank you po.
Thank you. And may we hear from Cagayan de Oro, from Mr. Lito Joseph Prasuela. Please unmute, please.
Yes, hello. Good morning, everyone. I'm Lito Joseph Branzuela. I'm from Cagayan de Oro. My friend, my colleague invited me this morning, Giancarlo V. Iway. And I am here to learn more about the shadow government of 1899 Republic of the Philippines. So I am just newly entered. I joined this virtual meeting regarding the shadow congress. I'm also a law school student right now, so it is so very helpful for me to study this constitution, the true constitution of our country. That's all, and thank you.
Okay, thank you, future lawyers. Al, may we hear from you?
Hi, Sir Bien. Magandang araw po. It's really an honor to be here sa 1899 Congress, Shadow Congress. And I really believe what you're doing here is of utmost importance. And this is a transition of bringing back the power to the people. So that's why I really support this movement. And in any way, talaga pong ano, I am one of you, and I observe yung mga movement po natin. Sobrang importante po ng ginagawa nyo. And siguro kung may idadagdag lang po ako is or i-bring up is siguro yung ano, yung timeline of events. We can file, no? We can file to the government, talk to the government, no, about the 1899 constitution, no? But for me, this is just me again. I tell everyone, do not believe what I say. No, do your own critical thinking. For me, the current government system is a tyrannical structure. And for example, during our fight, during sa pandemic, scamdemic, they're not necessarily willing listeners, no, para sa akin. So if I may just add something to the group, hindi naman ako sa pagiging ideal, no, but I'm also looking at what other countries are doing. Like for example, France, they're already successful, and they can implement their original constitution anytime kasi yung mga tao po nasa labas na parang yung totoong government, alam na nila kung sino sila, the people, we the people. So ako, I believe, no, para mabilis nating maibalik ang 1899 constitution is we should directly talk to the people. No, pag nagawa na natin yung, para sa akin lagi kong kinakampanya to, yung tunay na people power. Pag nangyari po yun, ang 1899 constitution, it will be easy peasy, no, na andiyan yung lahat ng tao, imagine niyo. Tas andiyan sila Sir Bien, andiyan sila Carlo, tas ano, Sir Gil Ramos, andiyan. Let's do the 1899 constitution. We are the government. We have the military with us. We have the religious sector with us. We have everyone listening to us. And let's put it to a vote. What I'm noticing, so I just want to give you everyone here some hope. No, na there is a global pattern of power returning to the people. Parang iniisip kasi ng tao na natatapos na yung mundo natin. No, parang it's like apocalyptic or what? Everything's chaotic. No, but no, it is just the death of the old world, death of the old guard. No, na sobrang baho na ng old system na ngayon, mas marami ng tao ang nakakapansin. We are all in this one battle. Ano na, isa-isa lang eh. So for example, bakuna muna, 'di ba? Para kasi hindi naman tayo makakabuo ng tao sa labas kung takot yung mga tao sa virus eh. Hindi naman tayo makakapag people power kung takot mga tao lumabas. So bakuna, mawala yung takot ng mga tao, lumabas, and then yung 1899, maano kagad natin, magagawa kagad natin ng mabilisan. No? Ganun ang para sa akin. no, even if we talk to the government with 1899 digong, no, we want to bring, but we're talking to sorry to say, ano na, influenced already. And I'm going to tell you the truth. Duque is more powerful than Duterte. No, Freemasonry, sorry ah, gusto ko na kayong diretsuhin, mas mataas ang rangko ni Duque. So if we're talking to Duterte, for me it's nonsense. No, ako, I voted for him 2016. I voted for him and I campaigned for him, I supported him. But this time it's not about the president anymore. It's not about the government anymore. It's about us, we the people. So, yun po yung nakikita ko. No, na let's unahin muna po natin yung ano, yung mga tao. And 1899, babalik din yan. No, I would also like to tell you the truth, no, that the Filipino is the mga Asians, yung mga lahi natin, brown, black, are the most subdued people. Ay yung parang for hundreds of years, parang pinagmukha tayong mga alipin. Binaon sa takot. No? For me, they even used religion as a tool, no, to scare people to submission. Di ba? So 400 years, 500 years, ganun po ang ano natin ngayon, ang ginagamot natin. So huwag na kayong magtaka kung bakit nauna ang France na maging malaya. Huwag na kayong magtaka kung bakit US ang naunang maging malaya, UK. No, kasi tayo ang pinuntirya. Yung lahi natin, brown and black. Tayo ang pinuntirya kasi tayo yung magaganda yung ano, yung spirit. No? Haven't you noticed? Sa buong mundo, Filipino culture outshines. We are the most hospitable kahit nasa Antarctica pa tayo, kahit nasa Alaska pa tayo. We smile through all the struggles, but our oppressors took advantage of that. They made us, isipin nyo, may mga dictionary pa before, ang ibig sabihin ng OFW, Filipino, di ba, na domestic worker. Nasa na yung dignidad ng Filipino? I'm telling you all right now, no, na yan ang kailangan nating unahin, yung moral, dignidad, and belief. That's why, kunyari, si Sir Lito Branzuela from CDO, I appreciate na you being here learning about our constitution. That's the first step. That's the first step kasi yung mga tao ngayon, dependent sila sa, ano eh, sa gobyerno. I'm going to tell you a story. I was in Cavite 2 weeks ago and nasa harap ako ng mini stop. I was in mini stop. And then may parking attendant na lumapit. Blah, blah, blah. Eh, may poster kami sa harap, no, to experimental vaccines, mga ganyan, ganyan. So, nabasa niya. Di ba? Sabi niya, ay, ganun po ba? Di ba, di pala kailangan magpaturok? Tapos, napunta yung usapan namin. Ang sinabi ni Manong, pagmamay-ari ako ng gobyerno. Sabi niya nun, eto po yung nagiging challenge natin sa ano, sa buong bansa, ang akala ng tao. Pagmamay-ari sila ng gobyerno or kailangan nilang sambain or sundin yung gobyerno, eh paano kung mali na? Eh sa totoo lang, the truth is, we the people, the power, the sovereignty resides in we the people, and the constitution is just a proof of that. We don't even need to bring the paper. The rights emanates inside of us. When nung pinanganak tayo, we have the common law, we have the natural law. That's all we need to, ano. So ako, para sa akin, kaya tantamount that we unite each other and empower each other, kasi po yun yung pinakasakit ng tao. Wala nang dignidad ng tao. Ang Pilipino, wala nang moral. Takot na takot na para lumabas. No, pag inuna natin yun, easy peasy na yung 1899. So, I would just like to tell you guys, let's take advantage of what's happening right now. Why? COA. COA is so hot. No, they are on the hot seat. DOH and the president and Duque, di ba? They are all on the hot seat. Na pag yun nang yun yung ano yung parang there is the government has an armor, like an impenetrable armor, pero nakikita na natin na nabibreak na siya. Meron ng chinks sa mga armor. Eh anong gagawin natin? Magkukwentuhan pa ba tayo o aakto? Kasi sa totoo lang, the streets is the easiest way to 1899 constitution for me. No, and I really love what you guys are doing because you are preparing the people for what's going to happen. So, ayan, again, it's an honor po to be part of here. And ako, I will do my part or whatever to contribute sa mga tao. And I would just like to remind each and everyone na yun nga, unahin natin yung spirito ng Pilipino. Someone, when I came back in again, someone was talking about a change in name. No? And sabi ni Sir Bien, na a change in name not necessarily equates to success. Right? So, para sa akin, yung change in name is also like a change in perspective. Diba? Yung pangalan kanina ng isang tao na pinalitan, nung pinalitan yung pangalan niya of something spiritual, right? It talked sa loob niya. Diba? Inside, for him to do something about it na, ay, hindi lang ako ito eh. No? So, perspective ng iba dun sa name change. So, yun yung kailangan natin gawin sa mga Pilipino. Perspective change. Pag sinasabi mo kasi Philippines, Pilipino ka, parang okay naman, nasanay na tayo dun eh. Maganda naman yung term na Pilipino eh. Pero yun nga, yung a more neutral, ako wala akong pakialam dyan. No? Even when I started Gising Maharlika, I don't want any name. No, I don't want any name. I just want everyone to be united. No? And even people are, inaasar nila yung pangalan na Maharlika na, ah, gusto mo mas nakakataas ka sa ibang tao. Gusto mo ikaw yung hari, mga ganyan. Hindi po. No? It's just a reminder that we are not slaves. We are sovereign people. No? The time of slavery is done. No? But the worst kind of slavery is mental slavery. Gusto ko pong i-remind sa atin lahat yun na yung mga Pilipino yung po yung na-experience. No, hindi nila mangunguya ang importansya ng 1899 Constitution kung takot sila. Kung takot silang lumabas, kung di nila alam yung karapatan nila. So we start with their spirits and only we can connect with the spirits if we connect with them, talk to them, have dinner with them, have one beer with them. So yun yung ini-encourage ko ngayon. So for example, everyone here as a community, right? Why not? For example, in the Gising Maharlika movement, we have a lot of GM communities already. Nakikita sila every week. Kumakain sila, nagbabanding, nagpa-flyering, naglalabas ng posters. So yun, I encourage everyone to have a freedom community. We have a tyrannical structure right now. A tyrannical government. Shadow Congress, this group, is an example of a freedom community. So let's keep on empowering it, but also on a physical level. Now, for example, we have this Zoom meet. Why not in your own place talk about the 1899 Constitution? Why not in your own place talk about your freedoms? So, yun lang. Again, Serbian, it's an honor to be part of this. And I love you all.
And may we hear from Ma'am Vipanya Valdez? Ma'am Vipanya? Can you please unmute your audio? Okay. Please unmute your audio, please. Ma'am Vipanya Valdez. Probably is not 3D and Mr. Vicente
Sunny
Abolusyon. Just a moment, Sunny, you will be the next. Abolusyon, please unmute your audio.
Okay.
Thank you.
I am unmute already.
Okay.
I was expecting many participants, but we are only 23. I am expecting thousands of us because this is not only Philippines. I think this is worldwide.
Yes,
among Filipinos. It's hard for us to assimilate Mindanao because of their movement of being separate. If we give them what you call that.
Bangsamoro.
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 They can anytime affiliate with other nations, neighboring nation, with Malaysia. So what's the point? What's the point? Let us maintain our republic. Let us maintain our republic. For all you know, if you know Islam, once they are in power, they want to have caliphate. They want to have Sharia law. First of all, they will have a Sharia law in their own area, but they have the expansionism philosophy. It will expand and expand and expand. Do they want to have Sharia law all over the place that they want to?
So, what is your point, by the way?
What?
What is the main point? What is your main point?
I am not in favor of the Bangsa Moro organization.
Okay, nothing on that.
It will divide us rather than unite us.
But in the beginning, what we are doing here is that we must have to respect the freedom of one another, because that was been written in our constitution. If that is their own feeling, to them is good, but to others it is not. But what I mean is that let us respect one another, being a united Filipino citizen of our Republic of the Philippines.
You know, you have to know Islam. Most of the Mindanao people, the Islamic Mindanao, are not really religious Islamic.
By the way, may I cut you, please? By the way, I would like to remind everybody that we are not here to challenge everyone. We are here for unity. So please avoid blaming one another. If you have something grievance with them, so that's you'll be done in public, but not in the shadow government. Because the very intent of shadow government is to change the constitution of the Republic of the Philippines, which is 1987, which are being violated by the sitting government officials. Now, if we have to discuss grievances here, so what is the use of adopting the 1899 constitution? Meaning, what you are talking is that is out of the context of the intent and purpose of this shadow government. I'm very sorry for that to say, but for those who are here, I will have to repeat that the very intent of this shadow government is to reform the constitution of the Republic of the Philippines, which were being abused by the sitting government official. That's
Mr.
why.
Mr. Speaker, can I be recognized, Mr. Speaker?
Okay, Professor Hill, you are recognized.
I could not control much of my presence there because I am mobile right now. I am on the verge of meeting with more people who are here in the MGM Grand Garden Arena, where right now Senator Pacquiao is holding a Bible study. But the reason why I'm here is not to support Pacquiao in his, planned bid for the presidency. Our shadow government group wants to dialogue with all presidential candidates and talk with them about the advocacy that we have for the shift of government to a parliamentary setup. A parliamentary setup that would have a very strong question hour, which would expose the corruption of the country. In my meeting with one of the advisors of Senator Pacquiao earlier today, he said that the senator has prepared a 12 rounds for the people document. He is saying that he will be most likely having his last fight now with this Ugas fight, And whatever the outcome, he would be perhaps leaving boxing. But then he would launch his campaign for the presidency by saying that I am leaving boxing, but I will go 12 more rounds for the people to help the country free itself from the tyranny and the oppression that we have. He said, 12 more rounds for the Filipino. And number one in his 12 rounds of a platform is the fight against corruption. And I discussed with one of his people earlier today that the best, one of the best weapons to expose corruption is a parliamentary question hour process. We have a parliamentary in the setup in the past with Marcos under the Batasang Pambansa Parliament, but it had no question hour that was that can strongly question the way Marcos was governing the country. So what I'm trying to say now is that other points I did not. The whole 12 points are concerning the welfare points like food security, housing, and health and education, and other stuff. But we did not discuss those points anymore. But I hear the statement of the speaker of our government of our shadow house saying that we should not go into one issue grievances against particular groups of our people, like the person who just spoke before me talked about against the Bangsamoro. Well, the Bangsamoro is a people, and if you studied our history well, in the fight against the Americans, when the Americans declared war to our fledgling nation in 1899, our leaders were subdued around 1902 and 1906. That is when they beheaded or hanged Macario Sacay, the third de facto president of our republic, after Aguinaldo, then Malvar, then Macario Sacay. But after that, the Bangsamoro people continued to fight on that year, and we had the massacre at Budahu. That's what President Duterte raised in the ASEAN meeting, where he said, putang ina kay Juan, kay Obama. And then he also, you must also remember that in 1916, the Bangsamoro people continued to resist, and they fought in Budbagsak with Dato Ampil and his followers being massacred again by the Americans. So we should not just say sort of racial slurs to the Bangsamoro people. They are heroic people. That is why we have a province called Sultan Kodarat, because Kodarat was one of those who continued to resist the Americans even after they dominated parts of Luzon and the Visayas. I understand that we are not so familiar with our history after 1899, because a cultural curtain was placed on it by the Americans by letting us forget our Spanish heritage and language, which was the language of resistance and reform, which our people wrote in, like Jose Rizal in his Noli and his Philly, Bosterismo. So we should remember that we now have the luxury of instant translation engines in the web and in other places to learn about our history. We have to know the drama of the 1890s. We have to know that the people who fought were young people, 30 years old, 28 years old, 35 years old. I am now 70 years old. I am twice the age of those people who fought. But the young people now are ready to fight also. But right now they feel a sort of, I admire the passion and the fervor of the way Al Santillan speaks. That is what I would like to see from our young people. And understanding our history is a process that we should go through, because our history is a proud history. We are the first people in Asia who introduced constitutionalism into Asia, ahead of Russia, ahead of China. The heroes of Mao Zedong and Chiang Kai-shek, Dr. Sun Yat-sen, admired our revolution was somebody who considered Jose Rizal his idol. So we should be proud of that history and learn from it, fortify ourselves with it as we go and fight for these things that we are pursuing now. Now, as the speaker has said, that the purpose of our group is to talk about a resolution, asking the president, putting him on the spot, to fulfill his promise of a revolutionary governance by proclaiming a shift of the country to the 1899 Constitution. So I understand that somebody has requested that that resolution be read. I cannot read it here because I just have a cell phone. I cannot have my files and I cannot read it. I would request the speaker to read the resolution that I have crafted together with the words from Dr. Roberto Posadas, and read it, and then we can present it on the floor, and I am ready to defend it, and I can be interpolated about it after the speaker reads that resolution. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Okay, thank you, Professor Hill. Although I had recognized Sunny, but if you may, can you honor the request of Professor Hill that I have to read the resolution so he could answer any interpolation, if any, for the information of the whole group. However, although as mentioned by one of our colleagues, Abolition, that he does not expect a small group of people. But you know, you have to remember the history that when Andres Bonifacio organized the Katipunan, they are only small in numbers. However, when the group of Filipinos recognizes that there is a chance of winning, so a lot of people join Andres Bonifacio. But because of this Filipino manner we're in, from the very beginning, we do not cooperate with one another. So there was a failure in that particular fight. And ang iba dyan na naman tala, yun pa ang na nagwagi. Okay, so Attorney Posadas, now I will be reading the resolution made by Professor Hill. And for those of you who are here, you hear from Professor Hill that he is ready to answer the any interpolation, if any. So may I start? House of the Representative, House of the Shadow Representative of the 1899 Republic of the Philippines. The nation is invited to deliberate on this resolution in a Zoom meeting, August 21, 2021 at 8 a.m. to 12 noon. A resolution of transmittal to the Office of the President of the proposed proclamation enforcing the writ of 1899 Philippine Constitution. Whereas there is a need for a joint manifestation from concerned citizenry reminding President Rodrigo Duterte of his duty to promote and protect the welfare of the people who are the position and ultimate wielder of power and sovereignty of the nation. Whereas there is a need, to uproot deeply entrenched government and oligarchic corruption as manifested in the way the utilities of water, power, tollways and communication are managed and controlled by private rent-seeking interests. Whereas the people are threatened by mandatory order through the overreach of police power, leading to unconsented forced pandemic vaccination that are breaching existing individual constitutional protection. Whereas the presence of millions of padded voters in the COMELEC registries and their potential use in the coming 2022 election represent a clear and present danger to the untrammeled exercise of the Filipino people electoral sovereignty. Whereas only through the invocation of the 1899 Constitution and calling for the shift of allegiance by the Filipino for the de jure 1899 Philippine Constitution, can we clear up the cheating and dishonesty of our election process so the sovereign will of the people can truly be reflected in genuinely mandated governance? Whereas amendment to the 1899 Constitution can then be crafted so as to be consistent with the existing municipal law and the letter and spirit of that Constitution as well, updating the retrofitting it to fit for our current requirement. Whereas by adopting a parliamentary setup as embodied in the 1899 Constitution, the practice of the head of the government facing his her member of parliament periodically to explain transparently governance operation will expose the maggot of corruption in our midst, thus mitigating, if not eliminating, this cancer that permeates our rotten presidential form of governance. Whereas the 1899 Constitution will not just be transition constitution, but will be our actual constitution henceforth, just like the 1776 and 1789 Constitution of the United States. Whereas the Filipino people has always been the repository of the nation's sovereignty, and the welfare of the people is the supreme law, and the voice of the people is also the voice of God. Whereas the 1987 Constitution has become a constitution of convenience, with its crucial provision flaunted and ignored like Articulo 12 that must be implemented in time of crisis, as the current pandemic shows, mutilated the illegally amended like the invention of constructive resignation to justify the unlawful move to oust the legitimate era president, ignored blatantly and persistently as in the political dynasty injunction that up to now has no enabling law decade after this constitution promulgation in 1987. Whereas, in fact, you, as our president, on many important occasions, challenge us all Filipinos and the armed forces of the Philippines as to whether we prepare to support you in the declaration of a revolutionary government. Whereas only by either your declaration of a transition to revolutionary government or similar action by the protector of the people, can we as a nation impeach the flawed presidential system that has been dominated by oligarchic and feudal influences and shift to the parliamentary governance under the 1899 Constitution. Whereas otherwise, all our effort now and the blood, sweat, and tears of our forefathers would be in vain with a social and political malaise that would continue under the already broken 1987 Constitution without the necessary shift to the 1899 Constitution. Whereas we, under your leadership, should not allow this historic opportunity and appointment with destiny to slip through our fingers during this exigent time where bold and courageous choices and decisions are called for. Whereas you are our last light in our time channel, and our final beacon of hope for the future generation. Elsewise, we remain adrift in the sea of rudderless uncertainty, disparate, and destitution as a nation. Whereas we the people, together with you, jointly and urgently stand with you to invoke your constitutional oath of office and duty to redress this multifarious grievances now confronting the nation. Whereas you and the people are both contractually bound to perform such respective duties, to abide by the rule of law, whereas a los populi is suprema lex. Therefore, be it resolved, and it is hereby resolved, to reinstate the writ of our de jure Philippine Constitution promulgated in January 23, 1899, by Captain General and Commander-in-Chief of our armies, Emilio Aguinaldo, and for the same to be enforced by Your Excellency Rodrigo Roa Duterte, current President of the Philippines. Resolve further that this assembly of citizens affixing their signature to their document stand with you as our president in using your mandated power to redress our collective grievances by enforcing the writ of the 1899 Philippine Constitution as the ultimate organic law of the land. Resolve further that President Rodrigo Duterte and or the leadership of the armed forces of the Philippines in their natural role as protector of the people, ensure a peaceful shift of their allegiance from the broken de facto constitution of 1987 to the supreme and sovereign 1899 Philippine Constitution. Resolve further, should President Duterte swing his oath of duty and address our call for the collective relief of our justified grievances by enforcing the writ of the 1899 Philippine Constitution, then we, the signatories to this document, in the alternative, will stand with the protector of the people to provide relief to our collective grievances as needed. Resolve further that a draft of the required proclamation be presented as follows to the office of the president and the same be adopted accordingly. The proposed proclamation follows. Proclamation number XX series of 2021. A proclamation enforcing the writ of the 1899 Philippine Constitution. I, Rodrigo Duterte E. Roa, by circumstance and development of event during the dormancy of the 1899 Constitution, now recognized by extant law in the interregnum as President of the Philippines and Commander-in-Chief of its armed forces, acknowledges that the Assembly of Representatives of the Nation in 1899 and President Emilio Aguinaldo E. Fami, by virtue of sovereign power vested in them, had decreed and sanctioned the political constitution of the lay of the state done at Malolos on the 21st of January in the year 1899, to be enforced and ordered authorities, civilian as well, as military, civilian as well as military, of whatever class or rank, to keep it, cause it to be kept, complied with the complied with and executed in all its part because it is the sovereign will of the Filipino people. Guidance from this office will be issued in accordance with the appurtenant transitory provision as sanctioned in this 1899 Constitution of the Republic. By the power vested in me as President of the Republic, then this city, this day, kung kailan niya gagawin to, kung gagawin man niya, in Manila, Malacanang Palace. Signed, Rodrigo Roa Duterte, President of the Philippines. That is the end of the proclamation. And resolve further that this resolution calling for the enforcement of the 1899 Philippine Constitution as passed in the Assembly of the Shadow 1899 Philippine Congress be circulated throughout the Philippines using all form of media and to collect signatures of approval and support from all Filipino citizens. So help us God. Then this day of August 2021 by the 1899 Philippine Congress session year 2021. Signatures. Speaker of the 1899 Philippine Congress, Bienvenido Lorque, in attendance with signature collected by web circulation and signature collected physically by Congress District. So what we did is Professor Hill asked me to provide interpretation in other dialect. So what I did is I provided translation in Cebuano and in Tagalog. And yesterday, Ma'am Wilma Manzanillo translated in Ilocano. And what I am waiting is the translation for Tausug. And that was already published in Facebook as a draft joint resolution. So for the time being that Professor Hill is still around, so for those who are here, so Professor Hill is ready for interpolation. Professor Hill, so be ready, and I think although you are quite busy there, but you can clearly hear what they are talking about here in the Philippines. Okay, so interpretation is granted. So anybody can interpolate Professor Hill. Attorney Posadas, you are welcome.
Okay, Mr. Speaker.
Okay, go ahead.
The main direct question to the proponent that we must put forth is this. How can a mere suggestion of a proclamation for one and only specific aim of instantly shifting to the 89 Constitution or just an open letter out in the public realm, even as it claims to be submitted directly to the Office of the President, how can it be inclusive or joined by other groups' transitional governance aims? They're not all for the 1899 Constitution directly, and it cannot be implied that we just want a specific aim for the 89 Constitution that is a joint and unified resolution, because you cannot imply consent or agreement by other people's revolutionary government objectives, and therefore cannot be implied as unified aim as an imperative valid constitution backup or a bridge to cross the gap of goals between organized groups. So a mere suggestion in an open letter domain of freedom of expressions are mere correlates and do not mean as a cost to build a bridge of which to bridge our historical horizon towards the parliamentary federal government, because there are two ways that we can resolve here, is that to either go directly for the president to proclaim the 1899 Constitution or a shift of allegiance to the 1899 Constitution, or to do it through a transitional revolutionary government, and then later on the 1899 Constitution can be retrofitted as consented and agreed by the Mindanao group, because they need time to digest the 1899 Constitution. But anything that makes the bridge towards the parliamentary federal government constitution should be welcomed and enjoined in a unified and joint resolution. It cannot be a unified and joint resolution or implied one, just merely asking for the president to proclaim the 1899 Constitution. That will, as a matter of fact, create a moat instead of a breach. You will now create a gap, because you will stand fast on the 1899 Constitution directly without asking them to at least adjust with us later on. But the most important thing right now is a joint resolution to at least declare or invoke the presidential oath of office directly under as a provision of the Constitution, so that it will have the constitutional force and the enforcement terms and conditions by the people as a contract. Because the Constitution, even the de facto 1987 Constitution, is a contract between the governed and the governing authorities. So it cannot be considered, if President Duterte does not proclaim the 1899 Constitution, it's not a violation of his oath of duty, because the oath of duty is office in the president's in the provisional as a provisional constitution is exactly for the president to address grievances, not just one aim, not just one proclamation of a constitution. And if he does not proclaim it, there is no dereliction of duty, because you did not directly invoke the constitution's president's out of office duty.
Okay, Professor Hill.
Wait, let me finish.
Sorry.
So all these above infirmities or devolvements are positively present in my original proposed unified joint resolution, a provision in the de facto constitution for the president to fulfill his duty to redress people's grievances and to exactly indirectly address what is happening right now, the exigent times of the pandemic. And most likely, if you declare instantly or directly the 1899 Constitution, it will create more disability, because it still has to retrofit into the present situation. Whereas if we take the transition government, there is the flexibility for the protocols and the implementation to be adjusted right away. See? So now the Constitution is a binding contract between the people and the authorities and the president. So if he derelicts on his duty, then the people, even as a matter of right and a contractual right, will now try to enforce it. How? They cannot take it by a mere proclamation. If he does not do that, the people cannot just take the law into their own hands and create rallies and civil disobedience. Whereas with my resolution, it will call on the armed forces of the Philippines.
Point of order, please. When a proposition is on the floor, the interpellator cannot make a proposition.
What? What is it? I cannot interpolate.
Please, no. Please go ahead within your interpolation, but it should be a little bit shorter, because if it is so long, all that word you had mentioned cannot be answered directly.
Okay. All right.
So make it a little bit shorter so Professor Hill could answer immediately.
So a mere dereliction of duty, mentioning of the dereliction of duty in the proposed proclamation, does not make it so for the citizens to enforce it themselves. And as President, as ex-senator and really said or commented, that this might be veering or crossing the border into rebellion.
Okay, Professor Hill. Answer.
What would you do? Instead of creating more stability with a transitional diversionary government as consented by the Mindanao group, we ask for a proclamation directly
now?
Of the 1899
Can the floor be given to me now?
Yes, okay. I already recognize you. Attorney Posadas, excuse me, but I recognize Professor Hill to answer all your word given to him.
Okay, okay, despite all the lengthy interpolation, the speaker is just saying he doesn't agree with the resolution. Therefore, he should not vote for it and he should not sign it. Okay, and I recognize the fact that not everybody can agree to what has been drafted. But I also used the same words that he used in the proposition because we were ordered by the speaker to mail the language and make the language of the original resolution clearer to the people. But the intent is very clear. So I tried to do what the speaker mandated me to do. The result is that resolution. If Dr. Posadas doesn't agree with it, he need not vote for it, and neither should the other groups that he claims to have 5 million members in Mindanao. That's fine with me. That's fine with the sponsorship of this representation. So that's just my reply to the lengthy comment of Dr. Posadas.
Okay, so for the information of everyone, the resolution made by Attorney Posadas and the resolution made by Professor Hill, we made merge on it. Ginmerge natin at kahit paman ibasahin ang resolution ni Attorney Posadas at saka ni Professor Hill, ay nandiyan lahat yan. Walang binawas. So therefore, as far as the question of Attorney Posadas is concerned, may we hear from other group or other person who are present here, what are their comment on that? What are their comment on the resolution?
Okay, may comment lang po, no?
Okay.
Siguro dapat bantayan talaga at masiguro natin na maitama ito at akma sa panahon ito. At may isa na akong question kay Sir Hill, no? Kasama ba sa possible changes ito ang mga changes din sa Department of Health yung dalawin natin papadala ng resolution dito sa ating Pangulo and Tiyatro di Posadas din?
Ang
Carlo,
ang sagot dyan ay ganito. The present presidential form of government, kung ma-ship natin sa 1899 Constitution, mayroon sa 1899 Constitution, that is parliamentary form of government. So my question hour dyan. So every week, you can question all sitting government officials at pakinggan ng taong bayan kung ano ang kanilang kasagutan doon sa mga katanungan. If the people are satisfied of what they say, so be it. And if not, then the people would have it and make action as by doing the their sovereignty in the that particular questionable ideas. So dahil parliament ang ibig sabihin nito, dinirekta lang ni Professor Hill na madali makorek ang kamalian kung parliament form of government ang pairalin kumpara sa presidential.
May question lang ako, no? Yes po, pero may isa akong question lang. How would it disimpact the Filipino people? The impossible resolution. How would it be the impact?
Ang problema dito sa atin ngayon, itong issue ng korupsyon, it's issue ng panamantala, ang issue ng panglalamang. So ang ibig sabihin ng resolution, gin-shortcut lang, gin-summarize lang, na kung parliamentary form of government tayo, hindi mo pwede na itago yung mga kamalian na ginawa mo. Dahil linggo-linggo, tatanungin ka ng mga mamamayan. So ang impact nito sa mamamayan, malaking pabor ang mapunta sa mamamayan kasi hindi sila pwede linlangin ng mga nakaupo sa gobyerno. Okay, Attorney Posadas, you are recognized. Attorney Posadas, please unmute. You have no audio. Please unmute, please. Attorney Posadas.
Pwede yung makasin.
Unmute your mic.
No, this is the shadow. Yes. I am responsible for the resolution. In the shadow of
Hindi ma-unmute. Attorney Posadas, can you please unmute your mic? Your audio.
Oh, now.
Okay.
Okay. Here's my main point. I am not disagreeing with the objective of the resolution from as proposed by Gil Ramos. What I'm suggesting is that the proclamation is not a direct invocation of the president's oath of office to redress people's grievances, in which when he does not proclaim, there is no enforcement. How do you enforce if it's not a dereliction of duty? Whereas directly invoking the president to choose between two ways, indirect transitional government, or after which, or directly into instant shift of the to the 1899 constitution. But preferably right now, because of the exigent times, it should only be a transitional revolutionary government so he can make the adjustment right away in the implementation of the pandemic protocols. Whereas with the 1899 constitution, even if he proclaims it right away, it will just destabilize because it will be a structured form of government right away that will not allow any flexibility towards adjustment in the implementation of the pandemic protocol. That's all I'm asking. Besides, it will not be a violation or a dereliction of duty in which you can ask the Armed Forces of Philippines to enforce. With my resolution invoking a provisional constitution to redress people's grievances, if he derelicts on his duty, then he should even consider himself resigned and for the armed forces to, because he cannot perform anymore his duty, so he should consider himself resigned. Or he can ask the AFP to help him or directly enforce the transitional revolutionary government in which immediately needs the adjustment towards the pandemic protocol. In the 1899 constitution, it's a structured constitution right away or a governing implementation. There's no flexibility because you need the time to make readjustment. With the transitional government declaration, he has time to adjust and be flexible in adjusting or correcting the implementation of the pandemic. So it's really practical and at the same time has the constitutional and legal force of our petition, because after all, this is a direct petition to the government, like the people joining in. The people who does not understand the 89 constitution right away needs time to be educated, whereas with a transitional government, then there will be time for people to make adjustments towards the implementation of the 1899.
Went to border, Attorney Posadas. Now, it was also mentioned here. That is very clear. You're right. Sinabi dito, whereas only by either your declaration of a transitory to revolutionary government. So either transitory or they have to declare transitory 1899 constitution or permanently put that 1899 constitution in place.
Yeah, but that must be clear, because in order for you to invoke...
It is very clear, because, look, I have to read again. Whereas only by either your declaration of transitory transition to revolutionary government or a similar action by the protector of the people can we as a nation impeach the flawed presidential system that has been dominated by oligarchy and feudal influences and shift to the parliamentary governance either under 1899 constitution.
So
in short, so therefore, the transition wordings you had mentioned was written in the resolution.
But that's a mere mention of a indirect revolutionary government. Does not mean, as a matter of fact, in the end of the suggestion or proclamation, he's putting the words of proclamation into President Duterte's mouth without even... He's got it ready to proclaim the 1819 Constitution. That's really confusing.
This resolution and what we are doing is only a mere recommendation. It is only a mere recommendation. So therefore, as far as recommendation is concerned, let the president also decide as to whether or not he has to honor our recommendation or he has to dishonor it. Let his power as a president of the Philippines mandate as to whether or not what benefits for the people.
No, he cannot mandate accordingly if you're not asking for the same thing. You're asking for two things. You're asking for two things. The proclamation, in the words of the proclamation, there's already suggested words to put into president's mouth for him to declare. That's not the same as asking his choice between the transition government or the 1899 constitution directly.
I rest my case. Professor Gil, reaction, please. Professor Hill, any reaction? So, Professor Hill is not around. So, Capre, something to say? Please unmute.
Yes, Brother Bien. Yes. Salamat. I've been listening to the manifestation ng lahat. At nandun tayo sa premise na may punto rin si Attorney Robert, regarding doon sa premise ng putting the words sa bibig ng ating presidente at yung ating recommendation. Now, para sa maintindihan ng lahat na nandito at sa mga nanonood natin sa major group chat at saka FB pages natin, ang premise natin para hindi masayang lahat ng ginagawa natin rito. Tama itong ginagawa natin na hinihimay natin ang ating proposed joint resolution para i-deliver sa ating mahal na Pangulo. Yun naman ang punto dito eh. Nauuna kong tanong, let us be realistic always para hindi tayo nagsasayang ng time. What do we think? Ano ang nasa kaisipan natin na itong joint resolution pag natapos is tatanggapin ng Pangulo, babasahin at bibigyan ng chance? Unang tanong yan. Pangalawang tanong, sa nangyayari ngayon, which is clearly narrated by Attorney Robert na may kinakaharap pandemic, in line dapat yung proposal, in line yung joint resolution sa nangyayari, dahil alam natin sa puso natin, ano mang isulong natin recommendation sa mahal na Pangulo, sa basurahan lang pupunta yan. Why? Dahil iisa lang ang sinusunod nila ngayon, yung medical martial law na meron tayo. So maganda yung hinihimay natin. Dalawa lang yung tanong ko na kailangan maklaro natin. Saan patungo yung ginagawa nating paghihimay ng joint resolution, at kung ang nilalaman ba nito is talagang papakinggan, babasahin, bibigyan ng halaga ng mahal na Pangulo. Kasi we may be exerting too much efforts. Nagpapalitan tayo ng mga kuro-kuro dito. Pero baka at the end of the day, lahat naman mapunta lang sa kawalan. Masayang lang lahat. So yung direction na tinatrahak natin, after this, ilagay na natin, okay, nag-agree na lahat doon sa joint resolution. Isasubmit natin sa mga mahal na Pangulo. It needs tangible, crystal clear manifestation of numbers ng mga Pilipinos, no matter if you're Christian or Muslims, na sumusuporta doon sa ating joint resolution. Kasi kahit anumang pagbabalik natin sa alinmang konstitusyon, still ang papakinggan pa rin kahit ng korte natin, Supreme Court natin, is the number of citizen ng mga Pilipinos na sumusuporta dito sa gusto nating pagbabago. So yun lang ang manifestation natin na Chief Bien. At ayaw nating masayang talaga yung ginagawa natin rito.
Dahil walang nakaalam kung ano ang nasa loob ng isipan ng ating Pangulo, itong ginagawa natin ay bilang pagsubok pa lamang. Doon natin ngayon makonclude kung tayo ba ay napakinggan o sinasayang lang atin na ginagawa sa ngayon. Kung makarating ito sa kanya at may aksyon sa gagawin o kung walang aksyon, doon ang citizen makagawa ng sinasabi mo na united citizenry action.
I agree with you, Brother Bien. I agree with you, Brother Bien. But I'm talking bank on our experiences. I will cite you an example. Marami ng grupo na sumulat sa mahal na Pangulo since 2020. Marami na. Marami na rin ibinasura.
Opo, mahigit na 6 na basura sa akin.
So ngayon, ang kailangan natin para hindi masayang, isabay na natin yung suporta ng mamamayan. Why we will shoot sa kawalan? Isama na natin. Para isang pasahan lang at makita niya yung numbers. Uy, may numbers itong sinasabi nitong Shadow House of Representative. Kasi bakit? Losing time na tayo. October, filing na natin ang mga candidacy registration na yan. And still, we are battling it out doon sa 9 million. So, ang sinasabi natin rito, maging realistic tayo lagi. Realistic tayo lagi. Isabay na natin yung mga sumusuporta na tao dito sa galaw natin para hindi na masayang.
Okay, kasi noted.
Ako, sa totoo lang, Brother Bien, galing sa puso ko, nanghihinayang ako sa mga grupo, lalo na malalalim ang pinag-uusapan. Tapos pagdating sa Pangulo, dadaan yan. Hindi babasahin kagad ng Pangulo. Maaaring papadaanin sa PMS dahil doon magre-receive lahat. Babasahin ni Medialdea yan. Sa level pa lang ni Medialdea, hindi na makakarating sa Pangulo yan.
Okay. But final if word.
State, final word. Present final numbers, M numbers, makita yung numbers ng mga Pilipino, baka magkaroon pa ng weight. Thank you, Brother Bien.
Okay. Final word. Okay, you're recognized.
Here's the bottom line. When the president does not follow the words of proclamation, it's not a dereliction of duty. So nothing constitutional or legal happens. Whereas if it's an direct invocation of his oath of duty, at the bottom line, if he does not perform, which becomes a dereliction of duty, it becomes a constitutional crisis. Why? Because this itself is a due notice to the Supreme Court, legally and constitutionally. So that's the bottom line. There will be constitutional crisis, and he will be forced to make a selection. Now, if he doesn't do that, then the armed forces has now the duty to take over. Whereas, if he does not proclaim, what will the people do? As Senator Enrile said, we might be crossing into the borderline of a rebellion. Because the proclamation, if he does not do the proclamation, what will the people do? They cannot invoke the Supreme Court because this
a proclamation is not a due notice to the Supreme Court. So now, not only that, it's already been adjusted accordingly by the schedule of the Mindanao group, the 5 million to 7 million strong. And at the same time, we are going to listen and coordinate with Missouri. There's already a schedule of which I'm not at liberty that will make sure that the president will take action. I'm not at liberty yet because it's only according to the schedule as Mick Feliciano as a representative.
So what is your recommendation, Attorney Posadas? What is your recommendation?
My recommendation is for my resolution to be adopted and approved.
And this resolution has to be disregarded?
No, the proclamation should be disregarded. Directly.
The draft proclamation should be disregarded.
Yes.
But the joint resolution with us and therefore has to be considered.
My joint resolution is the real joint unification resolution because it has.
No, what I mean is the content.
Other groups.
The content of joint resolution is also coming from you, except the proclamation by the president. So if we have to omit the declaration of the president, are you agreeable to that?
Do not suggest words into the president's mouth by making him proclaim directly the 1899 Constitution. He should choose between transition revolutionary government or the 1899 Constitution. Then it becomes a constitutional crisis at the very bottom that can be filed with the Supreme Court.
I said earlier that it's very clear. Either it is a transitory revolutionary government or direct to 1899 Constitution. It was very clear in the resolution.
It's just a mention. That's not a direct invocation of the oath of office of the president. It's just a mention. And a mere mention of dereliction of duty does not make it so. It has to be in the form and substance of the...
Are you agreeable with the resolution or not?
What resolution? That's a resolution to proclaim, or President Duterte to proclaim. It is not a resolution to invoke directly the 1987 provision in the Constitution for President to redress people's grievances.
Considering that we have to omit or delete the proclamation, we will not consider it in the joint resolution. Considering it is, we have to omit it. What will you be agreeable or will you oppose?
Just omit the proclamation suggested words.
Okay, Professor Hill, any comment on that? The recommendation of Attorney Posadas is to omit the proclamation by the President. Professor Hill, are you still around? Okay, from other audience, what are your observation and recommendation? May we hear from you.
Parang mayroong maayos talaga na dapat ayusin eh. No? At dapat ipaliwanag din kung ano ang mahalagang position nito. At suggestion ko kay Attorney Posadas, can you please explain more? Para mag-ibaliwanag lang tayo.
We are run out of time. Please remember because, once the filing of candidacy is already started, you could be possibly charged of election sabotage. You have to remember that. That's why I agree with Attorney Posadas that within the days remaining of August, if we can do something, we have to do it. Otherwise, then it's already too late. So, Professor Hill, any suggestion or any comment from the suggestion of Attorney Posadas? Professor Hill? So I noticed that the recommendation of Attorney Posadas is to omit the proposed proclamation by the President. And if we have to omit it, what are the reaction of the group?
Baka mag-species kayo dyan.
Any reaction from other audience? Ma'am Wilma, any reaction? Ah, Johnny, okay, you're raising your hand. Please unmute and say something. Johnny Bertosa.
Okay, Mr. Speaker, last words.
Okay. Word
of order. There okay. is no timeline in the resolution to proclaim. There is no timeline. So, in any contract, there is always an enforcement timeline or periods and performance to performance. Because the Constitution is a contract between the people and the president, if the president does not perform, for one thing, it becomes a dereliction of duty. So it's now incumbent upon the people to ask the military now to enforce it. Otherwise, then it becomes also mandatory for the people or imperative as a contractual right to anticipate mitigation of damages. The damages being there will be more vaccination, there will be more deaths, there will be more chaos, there will be more disorder, there will be more confusion. And at the same time, it does not become a due notice to the Supreme Court. Okay? So, if the president does not follow our petition to either declare a transition revolutionary government to make adjustments towards the pandemic protocols and implementation right away, then at the same time, the 1899 Constitution can now be retrofitted accordingly as to what the Mindanao group wants right now. They want right now action for at least a declaration of a revolutionary government, not necessarily okay. directly the 1899
noted,
Constitution.
Noted so
we
and that.
Support,
noted and that.
Support of the Mindanao group.
A point of order, Attorney Posadas. Noted on that. And I also agree with Professor Hill that we have to put a joint resolution because this joint, the word joint resolution, this is coming from you. You mentioned that in your presentation that you need a joint resolution. So in fairness, we give consideration to put that word joint resolution. But the real wording is there is only resolution. There is no joint.
No.
What can you say about it?
This is a joint resolution is an invitation for the other groups to join in. As a matter of fact, that's how the Mindanao group connected. Because they're unifying and joining yes. the invocation of the presidential's
okay. order. Professor Hill, reaction please. Professor Hill.
Yes, my reaction is just to put the proposition to a vote. And those who would not like to vote for it are free not to vote for it. That's fine.
So you mean to say that the proclamation has to be a tax?
Yes.
Attorney Posadas.
Okay.
Reaction, Attorney Posadas.
I will not vote for that okay. proclamation.
And reaction from Johnny. Johnny?
Yes, I came because I wanted to find out what are we going to do with the immediate problem of the moment. And all I am hearing is this thing about the Constitution. Does it mean that we cannot resolve this pandemic situation the way it's hurting the nation, the way it's hurting the people, the lockdowns and everything else? Do we need any constitution? All we have is the Nuremberg Code, and we can bank on it. The second thoughts I have is that the military and the police have been are really not part of the government. They're not supposed to just protect the government. They're here to protect the people. If the government cannot take over, well, then they should protect the people. And I think there should be some military activity here for we, the people, because the government is incapable of resolving this problem. That's all.
Okay, there will be a schedule And I'm sure I'm not at liberty right now to divulge what the schedule of the Mindanao group is going to do. But let me assure you, it will be enforced. I'm not just at liberty now because we're not clear on our... The reason why it's a joint resolution is for the other groups to join. It's not for us as joint members of Congress.
Attorney it's Posada's for the other groups to join. Attorney Posada's point of order. That's why there is such word joint resolution here, because this word is coming from you. And we obey and follow what you said. Now, it was followed. Now, you are now questioning this. Now, all these wordings mentioned in the joint resolution are the combined intents and purposes of wordings coming from you and coming from Professor Hill, except the proclamation to be done by the president. Now, correct. If your opinion is we have to wait for the other group to join in, and not even now they are here. So what can we do? Time is running.
No, okay. Just eliminate the proclamation words.
Okay, we have to eliminate if that is your recommendation. Yeah. But we have to ask Professor Hill as to whether or not he is agreeable to that. Now, if Professor Hill, to my point of view, if Professor Hill is agreeable to construe the proclamation and omit the joint and only resolution of the shadow government, I think that could be. But that depends upon you, both. So that's why I suggest from the very beginning that you communicate one another in order to do things smoothly. Sunny, you are recognized. Who was that? Sunny or Johnny?
Hello, can you hear me? Hello.
Up. Sino yan? I think Sunny. Okay, Sunny, go ahead.
Yes, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah, if I were the recipient of the resolution, and if I were the president, these are the questions I would ask. Is this resolution coming from 2/3 of the population, or at least 80% of the civil society? Second, will this resolution provide me a way to redirect and refocus my war against the pandemic? Since I am now being questioned by COA, and that it seems that my civilian government is not able to discipline the society, the country, the people towards a level of protocol that I like, that will now stop the picking up of the COVID, because that is the immediate reason now for any change that I would like to do with my government. Now, if the two questions are answered on the positive, then I would proceed towards accepting this resolution on condition that this includes all sectors of society signing up, and even civil society, and even academic society, and all those things that can be included. That's why I agree with Attorney Posadas that this is a joint resolution to include others. It is not just a resolution of our shadow government. That's what we are talking about now.
Correct.
Thank you.
Yeah, we consider that is correct. But what I am asking Attorney Posadas, because he is now questioning this joint resolution, despite of the fact that the wordings in this joint resolution is also coming from him. Some words are coming from him. Now, talking about the numbers. We did that before. However, I think you had noticed that the people nowadays, even Nakapre, he knows that when we marched in June 12 for the declaration of revolutionary government, we did not even reach 5,000. So that is how the people reaction today as far as this fight is concerned. So if we have to wait for the number, we know that it is more or less, if we have 8,000 in numbers, we could change the constitution, because at least 12% of the total registered voters with 3% from the district is more than enough to change the constitution. But this proposal to submit the resolution to the president is, this is only the initial action to be done, because we are run out of time. Then tomorrow, we could ask the signature from the citizen of the republic as to whether or not, what do you want, federal, parliament, but only revolutionary government, or whatsoever.
It is not, point of order, it is not a petition for inviting the president to fulfill his out of office duty. This is just a suggestion for the president to proclaim directly the 1899 constitution.
Correct. That is so clearly
with my original joint resolution, it means joint and unified, because it's inviting other groups to join in. And as a matter of fact, the Mindanao group already connected with it. There's already
a schedule. Point of order, Attorney Busanas.
That answers the number of people that are supporting this.
Okay. Point of order, Attorney Busanas. So because that is your preposition, my suggestion is like this. Submit your resolution, and this resolution has also to be submitted to the president, and let the president decide what he has to do as far as his power to govern the Republic of the Philippines is concerned. So there is no argument on that.
Your resolution has to be submitted.
I think that is more than enough to answer the question.
Mr. Speaker, how confusing can that be? You have two submission. One is a suggested or a suggested words for the president to declare, and one is a direct invocation of his constitutional out of office duty. Which has more force?
He has to select.
Huh?
He has to select.
It's a waste of time. The Mindanao group is ready to support my direct unified resolution.
Who is the representative of Mindanao group here?
Mick Feliciano.
Can you raise your hand here? Can somebody from the Mindanao group raise his hand? We will see. Because we are discussing things which are not in the presence of people whom we are talking into. And anybody here from Mindanao group, please raise your hand. There is none. So Sultan Arsiga, you are recognized, and please say something. Sultan Muhammad Arsiga. Yes.
Assalamualaikum. Waalaikumsalam. Wabarakatuh. Magandang tanghali po at isang karangalan na ako po ay kasama dito sa Zoom meeting natin na ito. Sir Bien, magandang umaga at lahat po ng mga nandito na hindi ko rin po masyado pang kilala, at kay Captain Ray, si Captain Ray, at si Kuya Hill Ramos. Sa akin po, isa lang ang solusyon, kasi wala nang kapangyarihan si Digong. Masisiraan na ng ulo yung taong yan eh. Kailangan po, para sa akin, with or without election, talagang kailangan natin isang military takeover na with the support of the Filipino people. Yan po ang para sa akin ang kailangan. Kasi kung halimbawa, dadayain lang tayo sa election, at yan naman ang plano nila, napapansin po ninyo, ano? Napakadami ng gobernador, napakadami ng mayor, sa iba't ibang probinsya, puro incheck na ang mga gobernador at mayor. Sinusuportahan pa ni Digong ang pagbili ng napakadaming mga lupain sa iba't ibang lugar ng Pilipinas. Ang dami ng pera ng mga Chinese na yan ay talagang Walang magagawa. Yung ibang mga kababayan natin, nagbebenta ng lupa, talagang daang-daang libong tarya ang binibili ng mga Chinese. So, ano po ang sinabi ng...
Point of order, Sultan. Point of order. Ang direktahin na lang natin because we are run out of time. What is your position as far as the 1899 question is concerned?
Maganda po ang 1899 Constitution. Pero sa kailangan palitan na natin muna ang nakaupo na yan. Wala na tayong magagawa po kay Digong para sa akin, Sir Ben. Ano? Talagang kailangan mapalitan ang namumuno sa gobyerno at saka na natin ipatupad yung 1899 Constitution na yan. Yan lamang po para sa akin. Pinakamaganda.
Okay. Mick, kayo recognize?
Mabuhay po kayo. Mabuhay po kayo.
Okay, well, from our point of view, no, we are trying to invite everyone to a unified meeting to unify everyone para magawa yung mabuo yung isang unified resolution. Mm-hmm. Now, as I was saying, the unified resolution can only be a suggestion, no? We cannot prod the president to really act on it. It's because number one, he has to always think about will it be popular, no? Considering yung popularity niya right now, which I guess would be plummeting down because of these mandatory vaccines and the COA, the actions that the COA, the Commission on Audit is doing right now, I'm really bent, and even my group, no, our Secretary General Noel Roganas is with us right now, and definitely he agrees to me when I say that we need people power. We need to move. We have the numbers, and it would be very welcome to invite everyone to join us to show that this would be the people's will. No, the resolution we will only show the way, an option. We're just giving the president the option which road to take upon declaring a revolutionary government. Right. So what we are trying to do right now is to push, no, what event or what can push Duterte to really act on it and make that decision whether to adopt the 1899 Constitution or declare or create a revolutionary or transition government. So that's all. Yun lang ang point of view ko na with I guess our officers with the Philippines for Visayas Federal Movement. By the way, I would like to correct Uncle Robert that it's not only Mindanao who's talking. You know, we're not only representing Mindanao but also Visayas. So Visayas in Mindanao, we are joining forces, and we have the numbers. No, everyone who shares the same view, for us to unify our individual resolutions, then I guess adopting this resolution right now would be contradictory to our intentions. So we present the two resolutions in our meeting in September 5, and just maybe if we muster the numbers and we get majority of the organizations nationwide who's pushing for federalism or a revolutionary government, then that's the only time we can say that this is a real unified resolution.
Yes, please consider that in June 12, we already declared a revolutionary government. And some other group last February also declared a revolutionary government. So the as far as revolutionary government is concerned, it was already been declared, but there was no action from the president.
Point of order.
Just a moment. There was no action from the president. So therefore, what we thought is, if we could declare, if we could send this resolution to the president, this is already a preparation for the people power. As to whether or not he agree, but we have to withdraw our own sovereignty. Okay.
Brother,
there is, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, point of order. Yes. There is a difference between a declaration coming from a suggestion from the people versus a direct declaration by President Duterte. A declaration by President Duterte.
If we have to admit, what will be your reaction? If we have to admit that, there is no more discussion about that. Let's omit the declaration of the president.
May I, Brother
Ben? Okay, Captain Ray.
Maraming salamat, Brother Ben. Nakikinig ako doon sa simulang nagsalita si Johnny, tapos si Nick, at nandito naman si Noel Raganas, at yung sinabi rin ng iba pang speaker. Nandun na tayo sa point eh. Itatama lang natin, okay. Sana pakinggan nyo ako ah. Napaka-importante nito bago ako, kasi may meeting pa ako mamaya. Napaka-importante nito kasi nandun na tayo sa perspektibo eh. Nire-respeto natin yung pag-conduct ng pag-declare ng revolutionary government noong June 10, dahil kasama tayo doon, Brother Bien. But the declaration is not the total sentiment ng majority ng mga Pilipino. Dahil group lang ang nag-declare doon, yung ating RG group natin. Sumama yung ating Gising Maharlika, sumama yung ating KDP. But that is not the clear manifestation na lahat, majority or even two-thirds nga nung ating registered voters or one-fourth ang kasama dito. Andun na tayo sa perspektibo, malapit na. This is only a matter of agreeing doon sa mga bagay na disagreeable para sa iba. Yung joint resolution, malinaw naman yung stand ni Attorney Robert na kung maaaprubahan yan, pwede pang sumama yung iba at mag-submit rin ng manifestation nila or kanilang position. So, alam ko maayos yan. Wordings, madaling ayusin. Content, madaling ayusin. Pero paano tayo mananalo? If we are going to bank na ang magsisimula is military, never mangyayari. Bakit ko nasabi yan? If ever any movement coming from the military or initiated by military at nag-fail ito, nasa hot water ang mga pet nila lahat. They will not do it. They will not initiate it. I know that. We know that from the heart. They know the Constitution. But, kung ang Filipino people, majority, ang magsisimula, and itong joint resolution natin at pinag-uusapan, ipapaliwanag natin sa military muna. Baka may maunawaan pa nila eh. Going directly to the president, it will go through channel. Nanggaling na tayo dyan. At ang final niyan is Senator Bongo. And Senator Bongo move away already from the federalization goal. Alam natin yan. I-research nyo. Mga kapanalig ni Digong, tumiwalag na sa federalization. Why? They are thinking already beyond ng mga Duterte term. Paano kung hindi nanalo ang mga Duterte ngayon darating na 2020? Saan sila pupulutin? They are playing their field now wisely. So the foremost that we must concentrate, may numbers na tayo sa Mindanao, may sa Bisaya, sa Luzon, gumagalaw tayo. And we are in the same perspective na ginagawa ni Sultan Muhammad Isa, na nakikipag-usap tayo, walang tigil sa ating mga militar, explaining to them three rationale only. First rationale, yung ating tinatawag na internal and external security threat. Yan ang pinapaliwanag natin sa kanila at lagigain na natin yung numbers. Hindi man umaabot pa sa 1/4, pero meron na tayong numbers ng ating mga noble policemen and military. Papala natin na convey sa kanila yung internal and external threat. Kapag lahat ng pulis na bakunahan at dahan-dahan sila nagkasakit, ganun rin ang ating mga militar. After 6 months to 1 year, dahan-dahan sila nagbagsakan. That will be a major internal and external security threat sa bansa natin. Yan, naiintindihan nila ng madali. Naiintindihan nila ng madali yan. Kaya marami sa ating PNP, hati na sila, at sa ating militar, ayaw magpabakuna. Pangalawa, intellectual dishonesty. Ano yung intellectual dishonesty? Lahat ng bakuna, hindi naman sinasabi ng DOH kung ano nilalaman yan at kung kailan lalabas ang eksaktong adverse side effect niyan. So may intellectual dishonesty na kagad. Doon namin sila ginigiba, nila Attorney Polly Sugilon at ni Attorney Aaron Sugilon at katulong ang ating mga noble lawyers at mga judges. Meron ng pagsisinungaling eh. Ibuhay natin ang nakasalalay. Dapat hindi sila nagkakaroon ng intellectual dishonesty. Lalo na nasa sangay sila ng ating kalusugan at buhay ang pinag-uusapan. Pangatlo, crime against humanity. Marami nang namatay, nagkasakit ng dahil sa bakuna. Alisin na natin yung premise. Mahal natin ng Pangulo. Yes, marami siyang nagawa. War on drugs, kahit di niya natapos, napatigil niya yung malalaki. Kahit dire-diretso pa yan dahil mahirap talagang masupil. Dahil involved rin ang malalaking politiko sa drug trade na ito. Alam natin lahat yan, di matatapos yan. Marawi crisis. Hindi naman siya military scientist, pero siya ang commander-in-chief at natapos niya yung Marawi crisis. Pero alam natin lahat, umpog natin, ulo natin sa pader pag sinabi natin tama pa yung ginagawa niya ngayong pandemic. Mali na talaga. Maraming nagsasabi niyan at sinusupress lang tayo ng mainstream at saka social media. So, bago ako magtapos, unahin natin, hikayatin ang sambayan ng Pilipino. Legally, huwag tayong pupunta sa illegal. Nanggaling na tayo sa gulo eh. Kaya natin makipagpatayan in numbers, lamang tayo. Ilan lang ang PNP natin at saka military? I-combine yung forces nila. 1.2 million, 1.4 million, 1.5 million. Isama mo pa yung mga politiko. Gawin mo silang 2 million. Ilan ang mga Pilipino? 110 million. Ang matatanda kalahati, 55 million. Lamang pa rin tayo. At huwag nilang sabihin na sila lang ang may armas. Yan yung reality. Pero bakit tayo pupunta ron sa madugong pakikipaglaban na pwede naman ito? Idaan pa rin natin sa batas. 50 person sa bawat barangay lang. 44,000 plus na barangay. 50 person lang. Gamitin natin yung ating barangay assembly. Gamitin natin yung barangay assembly natin, mabilisan. 44,000 plus barangay, 50 person lang ang kailangan. Makakabuo tayo ng at least 2/3 or 1/4 ng mga registered voters natin. Sumulat. At sa sulat nila, nakalagay yung tatlong bagay na binanggit ko. Internal and external security threat. Kasama dyan sa security threat natin, yung economic threat. Ano yung economic threat? Kapag nabakunahan, ang 10 million na overseas Filipinos, kasama dyan yung workers and non-workers, mga immigrants. Combine yan, 10 million. Kapag nabakunahan yan at nagkasakit lahat, sino pa magre-remit sa atin ng billion-billion dollars na tanging nagpalutang sa ekonomiya ng Pilipinas yung mga OFW remittances during the Asian economic crisis? Tayo lang ang nanantiling nakatayo that time. So yan lang po, tatlo na yan. Pinirmahan, pinadala sa mayor, ginamit natin yung barangay assembly under our local government code na mas matibay ito at mas malawak na sinasabi ni Attorney Mel Magdamo kaysa dun sa ating Republic Act 6735 na People's Initiative. Sa batas pa rin tayo naka-angkor. Ikulong man tayo ng gobyerno at nakita naman ng mga kapulisan at military na ang sinusunod pa rin natin konstitusyon, paano nila tayo hahatulan at ikukulong? Yung worst case scenario natin, lahat ng group will go to the fact na ito na yun. Hindi nila pinakinggan ng ating militar, ng ating kapulisan.
Ano okay. Kapre. Ano pansin
natin?
Kapre.
So, Brother Ben, salamat. Ay, gusto ko lang itama lahat ng tama yung pinag-uusapan. Gamitin natin yan. Pero sa tamang tao natin ibigay. Ako na nagsasabi sa inyo, it will not go further sa kamay ni President Duterte. maniwala kayo sa akin o hindi, it will go through channel. Dadaan kay Medialdea, dadaan kay Senator Bongo, never na yan dadaan sa kamay ni Presidente. Pero pag nakita nila na may numbers, may tao, may Pilipino na nagsusulong nito, hindi lang tayo, hindi lang ang mga major group, palagay ko papakinggan nila. Thank you very much, Brother Bian.
Okay, for some finality, what are your conclusion as far as this resolution is concerned?
Maganda,
all of you are being asked.
Yeah, maganda pinag-uusapan. At maganda, nag-a-agree tayo dun sa mga bagay na hindi disagreeable sa iba. Meeting in between lang. Okay naman yung resolution. May mga wording lang na kailangan itama. At may point rin si Attorney Robert na huwag tayong mag-feed ng words or action na gagawin ng presidente. Recommendation, pwede.
So doon sa suggestion mo, kailan natin gagawin? Because time is up.
It depends dito sa ating mga nandito kung papabilisin natin yan. Isasabit natin kung may boboto or hindi boboto, respect natin yung majority ng votes. Yun ang sundin natin. Lagi naman okay. Sa majority
na tayo. We are only 21. Who will vote for this resolution? Can you please raise your hand? For those who wanted to vote this resolution, please raise your hand.
Aling resolution yan, Brother Bien?
Binasa ko na resolution.
Yung binasa kasama ko na resolution. Kasama, hindi pa kasama yung ibang correction ni Attorney Robert?
Hindi, saka na yun. Nandiyan ang suggestion ni Attorney Robert Posadas. Dito sa resolution, ito sino ang boboto? Pakiangat ng kamay. At sa pangalawang question is, sino ang hindi boboto? Kung hindi man boboto, angatin ang kamay. Para mabilang natin, 21 lang tayo. We could not consider this even as joint group. Okay, Apre, you're recognized.
Napaka-critical noong mga keywords doon sa ating resolution. Yun lang ang punto ko. Huwag nating pabilisin para lang masabi na naisubmit natin at na-approve itong joint resolution. Napaka-critical ng bawat wording. Diyan na tayo nagkamali last year sa maraming sulat natin sa Malacanang, ayaw na natin mangyari uli. Yun lang, Brother Bien.
Okay. Kaya nga, Mr. Speaker, last word about Captain Valero's words. Yung sinasabi niya only reinforces the fact that a suggested proclamation for President Duterte to declare is only a suggestion, does not have a constitutional force or the legal force to enforce it. Whereas a direct invocation of his presidential oath of duty.
Okay, noted. The point of order, Attorney Posadas. My question is, who is in favor of this resolution that I have read a while ago? Please raise your hand. Carlo, are you in favor? Okay, only Carlo. One. And nobody else.
No, I have the qualification. I am in favor about proclamation.
Okay.
As we have discussed and as suggested by Captain Valera.
Okay. And the other question is, who are not in favor? Please raise your hand.
Of the proclamation suggestion?
Who is not in favor of this? Because I will ask after that. I will ask who will be in favor with your resolution.
Okay.
Purely your own resolution. Who is in favor with the resolution of Attorney Posadas? He read last session. But you have to remember that some of his words were also written here.
Point of order.
Tama ka, Brother Bien. Yung mga word na suggested na kailangan baguhin, ang premise lang natin isa. Huwag tayong mag-subo ng aksyon na gagawin ng Pangulo. Let him decide.
Considering
that recommendation lang. Yun lang. Kaya doon lang tayo sumusuporta sa posisyon ni Attorney Robert. Yung iba naman na binanggit mo noona, yung una binanggit mo, okay naman. Kaya lang, ang point lang natin,
Let's be specific. Ang nakalagay doon sa whereas and therefore, agreeable kayo. Ang ayaw lang ng grupo na mayroong presidential proclamation. Now, kung i-omit natin ang presidential proclamation, who is in favor with this resolution? I-omit natin ang proclamation.
Without proclamation.
Without proclamation. So, ilan ang bumoto?
Pwede po ba ano? Pwede po ba ako?
Okay. Sagadal, you are recognized.
Yes. Actually, hearing the red resolution, I was that's why I did not raise my hands on in favor or not in favor, because I was thinking of the, if you want to reach out to the different groups, especially the Muslim community or groups and the indigenous people, I think there is a need to consider their mindset so that we could embrace everybody's idea on the pursuance. Because listen, for example, our group is posing really for a revolutionary government. And this is for the federalism and parliamentary federalism. But we have to consider, listen to the points of, listen, for example, reaching out to Professor Noor Miswari, reaching out to other groups who are pushing in the same perspective. So that's why I am not considering favoring the present resolution, because we have to get the ideas, the heart and minds of those people who are also a big group to be recognized.
Correct. Okay. Noted. Now, we hear that particular recommendation from you. At what particular point shall we do that all your recommendation as well as the noted recommendation of others could be united? Please tell us. Anybody say something about that? What particular means, because of this lockdown, because of this vaccine, because of this what we call this inalagay sa ilong na yan, mahirap ngayon. So ano ang dapat natin gawin na ma-unite natin ang Luzon, Visayas and Mindanao maliban dito sa ginagawa natin?
Brother Ben, may I?
Okay.
For the information of everybody, kapag gusto natin, maraming paraan.
Okay, noted, Kapre.
Alam ko, hindi ko sabihin.
Okay, Congressman Willie Villarama, you are recognized.
Ang nakikita ko pong solusyon, marami na po tayong mga kasapahan dito na with organized groups already. So, yun ang idaan muna natin sa kanila. Dahil talagang hindi pwedeng mag-meeting physically eh. So, panay Zoom na lang ito, tsaka text-text, no? So, tinatanong nyo kung paano natin may kakaalat ito. So, once we have decided kung ano talaga ang gusto natin paratingin, we ask the help of people with the organized groups para ikalat nila, no? Gusto ko lang po mag-comment. Isa po akong taong takot sa salitang revolusyon. Dahil EDSA 1, EDSA 2, wala naman po nangyari eh. So, tama si Cap. Huwag tayo maglagay ng mga statements na pwede tayong ma-red tag, no? Let us be careful, no? Kasi mayroon mga sobra pagkaraitis. Pink pa lang, ginagawa na lang red eh. Yun lang po.
So doon sa resolusyon na binasa ko, ano ang nakita niyo doon na red?
Hindi. Ibig sabihin ko yung paggamit ng mga salitang revolutionary. Yun lang po.
Pwede po ba ma-recognize, sir?
Mr. Speaker.
Can you raise your hand?
Si Brother Noel Ray, Brother Ben.
Sunny, okay, you are recognized.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with the Congressman Villarama.
I-edit natin yan. Lagyan natin ng, ipa-edit natin ng maayos yan. Maalis yung mga inflationary. Maalis na rin yung contentious issues like declaration. So we can proceed. Kasi tama yung suggestion ni Congressman na, for example, me, I have my own Farmers Federation. I can join as chairman of the Farmers Federation that I lead. And others have their own civil society. So in the resolution, as to your question, how do we make the public know that this resolution should be supported by everyone going to the president? We can come up with a one-page advertisement where any organization can sign up and can send it to a email address, even in the email, plus email lang and everything, so that we can gather enough information, because that will now answer my first question when I said, if I were President Duterte, I will first look who are the people behind this, who are the organizations, what is their influence in their own sector. Do they represent the 14 basic sector also? Okay. They represent the non-basic sector? Do they represent the church, the army, and the even the oligarchs? Then I will consider to have an answer to my next question. Shall I now accept that my government, civilian government, even with military department heads, failed in the curing of the pandemic issue? And if the answer to the resolution says, by going to the transition government, he can now make use of the military to help him with a war against pandemic. This is now a war. We are now in a war. When a senior citizen could not get out 3 months, 1 year, that's a war against his own human right also.
Okay.
One final, Mr. Speaker, one final clarification.
Okay, go
one
ahead.
Final clarification. Now, invoking President's oath of office duty as a provision in the current de facto 1987 Constitution to completely and constitutionally change government system to parliamentary form of government is not the same as changing the person or leader or head of government. To change the person or to change President Duterte without invoking 1987 out of office duty to redress people's will grievances to change same system of effects of deep corruption is inciting to rebellion by citizens, or if led by the AFP would be a coup d'etat. So if you don't invoke the Constitution, 1987 Constitution, for him to fulfill his duty, it will be considered on the borderline of inciting to sedition or rebellion.
Okay. Point of order, Attorney Musandas. Point of order. That's why in the last plenary session, I informed everybody to exchange a mail para na maiwasan natin ang argument. Dahil if we keep on arguing similar to what the Congress now are doing in Congress, ang Department of OFW, apat na taon na pinag-uusapan hanggang ngayon, hindi pa na isang batas. Marami ang mga batas na ang mga bill na pinag-uusapan sa Kongreso. But because of argument, walang nangyari. Now, nangyari naman, nasa batas na. Pag nasa batas na, dahil may mga opposition at hindi pabor sa kanya, hindi nila ginagawa. So, I doubt that if ever possible, we should not follow what they did. Ibahin natin ang atin na kung baga, kung ano ang pabor sa mamamayan, majority will rule. Hindi yung pabor sa isa o lima o sampu o isandaan. Majority will rule. You have to remember that even in the change of constitution, sinasabi lang at least 12% of the total registered voters can change the constitution. Now, ang question lang ngayon, dahil mayroong lockdown, mayroong hindi ka makalabas, mayroong hindi makalabas sa bahay, mayroong pinagbabawal na distancing, although nakikita natin na sa simbahan sa Quiapo, may social distancing sa loob, pero sa labas, wala. So para bang mahirap unawain ang kalagayan nito. So kung mari, huwag tayo gagaya sa kanila. Now we have to change our system na maging favorable sa atin. Kagaya nung nakaraan, sabi ko nga na mag-exchange tayo na mag-exchange kayo ng mga email para doon pa lang makorek na natin ang mga kamalian. So nangyari dahil hindi kayo nagkaroon ng exchange of email, exchange of communication, ngayon nangyari ito. So walang solusyon ang problema. Gusto ba ninyo na magpatuloy tayo hanggang tumanda lang tayo, mag-inito tayo?
Mr. Speaker.
Okay, go ahead.
There is a difference between rebellion or inciting to sedition.
Okay, okay, point of order, Attorney Posadas. Did you send email to Hill Ramos?
It is not a question of sending email. It's a question of interpellation. You interpellate directly in the session.
Okay.
So what I'm saying...
The answer of Hill, I am not siding Hill. Nah? I am not siding Hill. But his answer is like this. You like to vote or you don't like. So that is his answer to your interpolation. So it looks like, to my point of view, that is quite different. Now, as far as your wordings are concerned, you also oppose the declaration of the president. Okay, that's why I say, if we have to omit, what is your suggestion as far as the joint resolution is concerned?
Here's my suggestion. Because in the suggestion to for President Duterte to proclaim is just a suggestion. It is putting words in his mouth to declare what? To declare the revolutionary government? No, specifically, it's asking for the president to declare the 1899 to adopt the 1899 constitution directly.
I think what he said is both. He is asking revolutionary government and he's also at the same time asking for the adoption of 1899 constitution. Now,
don't interrupt me, Mr. Speaker. Don't interrupt me because I'm you're defending already what Gil Ramos is saying. What I'm saying is, but for the suggested proclamation of directly proclaiming the 1899 Constitution, all the other words included from Gil's proposition without the suggested proclamation is okay with me, because with me, I'm invoking the president to choose between transition revolutionary government or directly to the 1899 constitution. Now, the proclamation suggestion is suggesting to President Duterte, putting words in his mouth, to declare the 1899 constitution. That's the difference. It will create more instability because of the pandemic situation. Okay.
Sometimes this
he will have a time to adjust and be flexible to address the implementation.
Point of order, Antonio Posadas. In the first place, I said that I am not siding Hill Ramos. Repeat, I am not siding Hill Ramos. Your interpolation, I said, your interpolation was being answered by Hill Ramos as to whether or not you are agreeable or you are not. That is what I mean. And that is very clear. But I have to repeat again, I am not siding his position.
Okay. Pwede po ba ma-recognize, sir?
How do we resolve the problem we are facing right now?
Okay, one final word. I don't agree with the suggestion for President Duterte to proclaim, because it's just a suggestion, putting words in his mouth to declare 1899 Constitution directly. Okay. What I'm saying in my resolution...
And send to my email... And I have to insert it there and consult Hill Ramos.
Yeah,
I will write my I will send you my email address. And for those of you who are present, because we are very limited time, you can check my messenger. I will put my email address there because Hill Ramos cannot answer directly because he is now talking with a group of Pacquiao in the United States of America. I'm very sorry that I was being misinterpreted, that I am presenting Hill Ramos. I am not.
Brother Bien, pakibigyan ng time si Brother Noel. Maglulobat na siya. Brother okay, Noel, okay. Ray.
Hello, sir. Okay. Marami pong salamat, sir. Okay po ba yung signal ko, sir?
Malakas.
Okay.
Sir, yun kasi nakikinig ako kanina pa. So, parang okay naman po lahat yung resolusyon kasi dapat tayo ngayon, we are running out of time. dapat mag-meet po ang resolution natin ngayon in order to present po. Kaya nag-invite po kami ang PBFM sa gagawing meeting ngayon. Nakaset po yan this September 5. Kasi this September 7, gusto na i-finalize ni Presidente Duterte kung ano talaga ang finalization ni Chairman Noor Misuari. And which is, ang nangyari kasi nito, dalawa po ang option ni Presidente. I agree to Captain sa sinasabi niya kanina. Ang ginawa po natin ngayon, marami pong intervention, maski sa military at sa PNP, hindi po lahat sa atin. Kaya sabi ito lang, kung didirekta tayo kay Presidente, meron pa ba tayong assurance na mapakinggan o mabasa, maski mabasa lang niya yung resolution natin? Wala po tayong ibang tsansa. Kasi sabi ni Presidente Duterte, during our meeting with Chairman Noor sa Davao, isa lang ang pinapakinggan ni Presidente Duterte when talking about revolutionary government at saka federalism. Kaya nung lumabas ang MRRD, lumabas yung iba, nag-meeting kami sa Davao to ask President kung lalabas ba siya talaga. Sabi ni Presidente, hindi ko sila ni-recognize. Isa lang ang pinapakinggan ko, Chairman Noor Misuari. So kaya yung 3 million PBFM members nag-join po tayo sa kay Chairman Noor Misuari. Wala na pong problema sa tao. Sinabi ni Senator Bongo, communicate si Senator Bongo pati si Presidente Duterte with Sir Eli sa nung meeting namin sa Radisson. Sabi ni Senator Bongo, lumabas kayo ngayong Marso para makita talaga kasi nag-submit kami ng manifesto kay Presidente. So kailangan ni Presidente makita talaga kung meron talagang suporta sa Visayas. Kasi wala siyang pakialam kung may suporta ba sa Luzon kasi naguguluhan talaga siya sa Luzon, frankly speaking. So meron na pong pwersa ang Mindanao. So whether may resolution kayo or wala, sirado na po si Chairman Noor. He will declare war against the government. Yan po ang sabi niya ni Presidente Duterte. Pag ngayong October, November, walang declaration ang Presidente, sabi ni Presidente Duterte, we will die together, Brother Noor. So binigyan ni Chairman Noor si Presidente Duterte chance to declare po sa kanya. So kailangan talaga ni Presidente Duterte makita yung pwersa sa Visayas. Kaya ang ginawa namin, lumabas kami kahit nasa gitna ng pandemic noong March 18, siguro yon. Lumabas ang Cebu, lumabas ang Panay Island, lumabas ang Bohol, lumabas ang Romblon, lumabas ang... Kasi yung Romblon, kabahagi sa sa Visayas kasi namin sa PBFM. So yung pati yung Masbate, lumabas. Yung part sa Mindanao, lumabas. So kung hindi marirecognize pa rin, ito lang chance natin kaya nag-invite yung PBFM. Wala na tayong ibang chance na ma-present. Kasi nabigyan kami ng apinto na hindi magiging bloody ang revolution natin. So nakita namin, kaya nakita namin sa shadow government, ito pala, meron tayong chance na ma-minus-minus yung collateral damage kung lalabas talaga. Kasi susuporta talaga ang Visayas pag lumabas na si Chairman Noor Misuari. So maski may armas man ang PBFM or wala, lalabas at lalabas po ang PBFM. We are organized po from the barangay level, municipal, pati po sa city. Mayroon na po tayong mga chairman, both political po at peacekeeping force. Kasi pag may resistance po sa mga kaliwa or sa mga dilawan or sino pa yang magre-resist, meron po tayong peacekeeping force. At meron pong feedback po sa Office of the President. Sinabihan po kami na kalma-kalma lang, walang posting po sa Facebook kasi nakamonitor po ang ibang side po sa military, lalo na po ang Office of the President side po sa intelligence kasi gusto nilang ipabagsak yung grupo ng PBFM kasi nakapasok na po tayo sa sektor ng military, pati po NPA. Hindi po ha, NPA po na original, yung hindi po NPA na na brainwash po ni Juma. Itong pong mga NPA na totoo pong nagsusulong ng revolusyonaryo talaga na para po talaga sa bayan. So dito po sa Bohol with the chairman po, isinisurecut ko na lang ito kasi we are running out of time. Ang hinihingi po namin ngayon, kasi nakita namin sa shadow government na meron po talaga kayong punto to minimize po ang bloody sa gagawin na ito. So hinikayat po namin kung meron mang representative po sa shadow government na sumama po sa amin doon, kasi wala po talagang ibang pakikinggan si Presidente Duterte. Yun po ang totoo. Only Chairman Nur. Kaya po ngayong 7, nag-sit po si Presidente Duterte, kahit po may pandemic, to invite Chairman Nur Misuari to come to Malacanang again para po to finalize. So sabi ni Chairman Nur, huwag tayong maniwala direkta kay Presidente Duterte kasi politiko po yan. So whether Duterte, susuporta si Duterte or not, lalabas po ang mga muro. So ito po ang chance na sasakyan po natin kasi wala na po tayong ibang paraan. O maski ano pang babalik tayo sa simula na naman. So we are running out of time. So yun po ang nakikita ko po na chance po natin na mag-represent po sa shadow government doon sa kay Chairman Nur para po mas maano pa yung draft ni Chairman Nur po sa federalism, mas ma-solidify. So okay, yun po.
One last.
Noel Rey.
Sige po.
Noel Rey, okay. narinig ko na yan na President Duterte might declare a revolutionary government on October or sometimes November. Okay. And nag-conflict lang doon because that was already filing of candidacy. Now, doon sa proposal mo that Nur Misuari wanted to talk to the shadow government, dahil ngayon ay lockdown at may mga swab test kung ano-ano pa ng mga requirement. So if you can manage to have a meeting in Zoom meeting na walang alis, kasi kagaya niyan, malampas ka na sa 60-year-old, hindi ka na pwede lumabas ng bahay. So kung lumabas ka man, may question na ang mga tanod, mga pulis, or kung sino-sino man. So in order to avoid argument for that reason, gawin na lang natin sa Zoom meeting.
Pwede po yan.
One last question. Ito pinaka-importante, Mr. Speaker. Yung sinasabi noon taga Mindanao, ito ang importanteng question. Will the Mindanao group or Misuari support the direct proclamation of the 1899 Constitution? That's the key question.
Okay.
Yes po.
He wants a revolutionary government, not necessarily direct to the 1899 Constitution suggestion for President Duterte to proclaim, putting words in his mouth. It's just a suggestion.
Point of order, Attorney Posadas. I've been in Mindanao in January 4 and 5. Doon ko nakikita na ang ginasigaw ng tao doon, not even read book. Ang ginasigaw ng tao doon ay federalism.
Precisely.
Dinagdag na lang nila yan, dinagdag na lang nila ang ribbog because nag-usap-usap na, imposible mag-federal ka without declaring revolutionary government.
Yes.
Nagsabi sila na okay, ribbog ay federal, mag-revolutionary government
ang federal. There are two declarations. One is a transition revolutionary government and one is a direct allegiance to the 1899 Constitution. It makes a difference between the MLF group. They don't like the 1899 Constitution.
So, with further argumentation, I will give you my email. Put your suggestion in my email address and I have to resend it to you what is my own opinion, and I will also publish to Hill Ramos and to some other group. My email address, you could find that in my wall, in my Facebook wall. So doon makikita ninyo kung ano suggestion nyo, padala nyo rin sa akin. Then we have to jointly merge.
Mr. Speaker.
The wordings para maiwasan yung argumentation. Okay,
I think the former somebody from Mindanao made those statements. I think he should answer Attorney Posada, because if he can answer Attorney Posada's question directly, because Attorney Posada is guiding us legally, para hindi tayo ma-redtag. Ang sagot sa kanya, dapat huwag nang hintayin niyang email. Sagutin na niya ngayon.
are they supporting the shadow government? If they're not supporting the shadow government, then problem.
Sane. No, they're supporting the shadow government for a revolutionary government transition.
Point of order.
Not Sane. Point of order. Point of order. This is very so clear. The MNL group is supporting the shadow government in its resolution for a joint resolution for a declaration of a revolutionary government, not direct declaration of the 1899 constitution.
Eh, sa iyo yes, galing yan ang 1899 constitution eh. Sa iyo galing yan. Believe you me. Sa iyo galing yan.
No, hindi galing sa akin yan. I gave in my resolution two choices. One is either a transition revolutionary government or a direct allegiance to the 1899 constitution.
The problem you is, what you have written, you
is direct to the 1899 constitution.
Your grandfather is the framer of 1899 constitution. Kaya nag-agree ako doon, nasundin ko sinabi mo.
Mr. Speaker, no. The question of Atty. Kusada should be answered.
Okay.
Yeah. To settle the issue.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Brother Bien.
Yes.
Oh, ito lang. Sundan natin yung sinabi ni Brother Noel kasi nandun na yung sustansya eh. Nandun na yung substance. Sundan natin yung sinabi ni Brother Noel. Clarification na lang. Teka lang, Brother Bien. Napaka-importante lang nito. Napaka-importante lang nito. Para hindi tayo ma-offshoot. Inline rin ito sa sinasabi ni Attorney Robert. Nandun na tayo sa premise eh. Huwag na tayo magbatuhan doon sa ano. Ito na, bumaba tayo doon sa level nila Brother Noel. Pakiusap ko lang sa inyo. Bumaba tayo doon sa kanila. Hindi sa level na sinasabi ko na mababa yung level niya. Ibig ko sabihin, doon sa Visayas at Mindanao, ito na siya. Galing na kay Brother Noel, binanggit niya, with or without the support ni President Duterte, they will go. Maliwanag yan, binanggit niya kanina. Ngayon, punta tayo doon sa dalawa kasi ang intindihin muna natin ito para sa kaalaman na nandito lahat at marami nanonood rin sa atin doon sa mga group chat natin. Para hindi tayo ma-offshoot kasi iniiwasan natin yung madugong labanan eh. Ayaw rin natin yung mga kapatid nating Muslim, mapunta sila sa isang kumunoy na hindi rin nakakapa kung ano instant talaga ng ating mga militar at saka yung nasa ground. Ito siya. Yung sinasabi natin na revolutionary government at yung federalism, dalawang bagay yan. Okay? Yung sinasabi natin at pinapangarap natin at pinagdadasal natin sa mahabang panahon na mag-declare na si President Duterte ng revolutionary government para mapatupad na yung federalism. Yun ang una. Ay, hindi na nangyari ngayon sa haba ng panahon. Kulang na siya sa time. Kaya naman lumutang, bakit hindi yung mga tao na yung mga tao, tayo, ang mag-declare ng revolutionary government, naka-anchored siya doon sa lumang constitution natin. Yun yung pangalawa na nakailangan nating linawin. Kasi magdadalawang bahagi yan eh. Andito ngayon si Brother Noel Rey, andito ngayon sila Sultan Muhammad na i-clarify kasi willing tayong sumuport. Kung yan is revolutionaryo ng mga tao ng sambayan ng Pilipino, our Christian and our Muslim brothers and other religions, Sama tayo dyan. Bakit hindi? So, napaka-importante ng bawat pag-uusap na ilagay na natin siya sa tamang perspektibo. Nandun na eh. Sundan na natin yung sinasabi ng Mindanao at saka Bisayan. Ang kailangan na lang nating makausap, harapan, sinur.
Yes.
Para sa bibig niya mismo natin marinig, ano gusto niya? Ano plano niya? At ano naman yung pwedeng isuporta ng kagaya nating mga ordinaryong tao at ng mga major groups na kinabibilangan natin para yung galaw natin in cadence, in consonance doon sa goal na gusto nating marating, yung tagumpay. Kasi bakit? Napaka-critical ng mga susuporta sa ating militar. Dahil pag tumaltak ito, court-martial sila lahat, garante sila lahat ng kanilang privilege, kanilang matatanggap sa retirement, mawawala lahat. Ayaw nilang mangyari ito. So marami na, hindi man lahat, sabi ko sa inyo, hindi nga umabot ng kalahati. Pero 1/4 ng ating mga kapulisan at kasundaluhan, naniniwala doon sa isinusulong natin na pagbabago. So yun lang suggestion ko, Brother Noel. At kung makausap si Chairman Noor, napakaganda at magkakaroon tayo ng tamang direksyon.
Ang gusto na Chairman Noel, hindi direct, hindi direct to the 1899 Constitution.
Apuento border, Atty. Posadas. Noel, please provide us a clarification.
Yes,
pwede ba mag-Zoom meeting kayo while doing a meeting with Norbeswari? Nakasama kami?
Pwede, hindi, pwede po yan, sir. Pero kailangan talaga may physical, kahit maski isa o dalawa na galing po sa shadow government na mga physically represent po doon. Kasi ito lang po. Ano po?
Saan gaganapin ang binyo?
Sa mismo talaga sa bahay ni residence po ni Chairman Noor sa Davao. So naka-set po niyan lahat whether mayroon pong shadow government o wala, pupunta talaga kami doon kasi sabi ni Chairman Noor at saka ni General Ulamit na kailangan natin ma-discuss ito, ma-present ito doon kay Chairman Noor kasi para mas mapadali natin madal ang concern natin na dito ay madaling makita or maunawaan ni presidente kasi ang kami dito po sa Visayas ito po ang nakikita naming paraan na hindi po like what I said minute ago na mami-minimize natin yung bloody na revolusyon kasi meron pa tayong konstitusyon na buhay ngayon na hindi mag-intervene yung Amerika, hindi mag-intervene yung ibang bansa. Kasi noong kasagsagan na always na pinupost ni presidente yung revolutionary government, pumunta po dito 500 CIAs po pumunta dito sa Pilipinas. Oh, confirm po 'yan kasi meron pong official ng PBFM na former CIA. So sabi niya malabo ito. So kaya nag-adjust si Presidente Duterte. Kaya sabi last meeting, kung hindi ako nagkakamali, siguro hindi ko talaga i-dokumento ito kasi we are on a Zoom meeting, marami pong nandito ngayon. So ito lang po ang sinabi ni Chairman Noor, ni Presidente Duterte. Kung wala na tasigang magagawang paraan ni iba, sabi niya kay Chairman Noor, Brother Noor, we will die together if hindi po ito mangyayari ang plano natin. Kasi for the Filipino people ito, ikaw na bahala, we will support you. I will bring AFP and PNP to support you. So meron na tayo doon. So ang nangyari lang ito na nandito kami ngayon is to present po kay Chairman Noor kasi iba-iba talaga ang perspective ng mga Moro. Hindi nila tinitingnan kung may masasagasaan o wala. Basta kasi 75 years po yung struggle nila na lumalaban po sa ating bansa na hindi lang natin nakikita siguro kasi nami-misinterpret po sa media. Tayo po, parati po tayong nagre-reklamo sa maling pamamalakad ng ating gobyerno through barbershop, through Facebook, through ano pang mga ways po na pwede nating ipalabas yung mga hinaing natin. Pero yung mga Moro po, hindi po ako Muslim ha, yung mga Moro po, mga kapatid, 75 years po nagsastruggle sila, dugo po ang binubuhos nila para makamtan at makamit nila ang totoong pagbabago, kapayapaan sa Mindanao. So, okay. Pwede pong mag-declare ng, kung wala talagang worst case scenario, meron ng plan B na pwede tayong mag-separate po sa Republic of the Philippines kung wala talagang susuporta yung Luzon. So meron na po tayo mga plan B, plan C.
Okay.
Direct question si Noel.
Kailan yung Brother Noel? Kailan yung meeting sa Davao, Brother Noel? Lilipad ako ng Davao.
Yes po, mas maganda po, Captain. Direct question to Noel.
Yes po, Attorney.
Yes, Noel. Anong gusto ni Ms. Wari? Transition Revolutionary Government or direct to the 1899 Constitution?
Yun po. Ang sabi po ni Chairman Noor nung nag-usap ang chairman ng PBFM, gusto po niyang pakinggan ang atin. Meron na pong draft. Meron na po. Pero gusto po niyang pakinggan yung sa atin. Kasi ang to enforce po itong draft po ni Chairman Noor, mayroon talagang collateral damage. So,
pero hindi nga, ang sinasabi ko is hindi yung 1899 Constitution hindi, hindi any revolutionary hindi government transition, hindi yung 1899. Yes, itong sinasuggest ng proclamation is to declare 1899 constitution. Yun ang sinasabi ko. Hindi niya gusto yun. Ayaw na kumuro yun. Gusto nila any transition revolutionary government and then it can be adjusted into the 1899.
Pero po, attorney, kung makikita nila po...
Nakausap ko rin ng iba mga bata nila. Ang gusto nila, revolutionary government na may federalism. At nakikita natin dito sa 1899 constitution, may federal form government yan.
Yes po.
Otherwise, susundin naman natin ang ginawa ni na Ding Ineroso at saka ni na Justice Puno, mukha yata nga ayaw rin ni Duterte yun.
Yes po.
Dahil matagal na ginawa yun. Nag-meeting kami na Ding, yun lang ang sabi ni Ding na revolutionary government is considered. Pero hindi pwede i-discuss in public.
Yes po.
At nag-declara rin si President Duterte, discuss it in public, pati sa militar, para malaman niya. So we heard news that Duterte is declaring revolutionary government by November. So I don't know how could it be done. Because my link is over.
Sa atin kasi brother Ben, pinakamaganda talaga makaharap natin si Noor para makuha natin from
yun na nga sinasabi
ko. Ano yung plano?
Point of order. Kapre, dahil mapunta ka ng Mindanao, can you just represent Shadow Government dahil ikaw
naman. Walang problema. Dadalhin natin kasi lahat ng ating position paper as is.
Galing dito sa Manila ang swab at saka yung kung ano pa ng mga problema. Kasi ako naranasan ko pumunta ng Mindanao pagdating ko doon sa General Santos, kung hindi pa ko pinasundo ni Gob Tamayo, hindi ako makalabas ng airport dahil garanti nila ko ng 14 días.
Ngayon,
dumating naman ako ng Davao. Hindi naman ako nila papasakayin na aeroplano kung hindi naman ako magpa-swab ulit. At mabuti naman, sabi ko nag-swab niyo si Panilo. Sabi nila
Mr.
hindi.
Speaker, direct to Captain Ray.
Let me finish first. Nung hindi na nang malaman nila na hindi naman pala na-swab si Panilo at kasama kami pumunta doon sa Mindanao, hindi na nila ako in-swab. So ang tanong, kung walang mga ganyan, malaking perwisyo sa atin.
Brother Bien,
hindi ako
dumadaan sa lupa. Hindi rin ako dumadaan sa eroplano. Dumadaan ako sa dagat.
Okay. Mr. Speaker, direct question to Captain Ray.
Okay, go ahead.
Captain Ray, ang tatanungin mo kay Noor Misuari is anong gusto niya? Direct 1899 Constitution, Proclamation, or a Transition Revolutionary Government? Yun.
Got it, Attorney Robert. Narinig rin naman ni Brother Noel. Yun lang tatanong natin.
Yes,
napaka-importanteng makaharap natin si Chairman Noor para sa bibig niya manggaling at baka naman meron tayong nami-misinterpret o meron tayong hindi nalalaman kasi lahat ng pinag-uusapan natin base lang sa second party or third party na nakakausap, not directly coming from him. So napaka-importante. Yes, tayo po ay susugal. Tayo po ay susugal na pumunta talaga sa Mindanao by all legal ways and means. See you there, Brother Noel.
Okay, yes po, yes po. Kung Bilirama, you are recognized. Okay, please unmute. Paki-unmute mo kung Bilirama. Okay. Okay, go ahead.
Mr. Speaker, Sunny Domingo, I will volunteer to join.
Just a moment, you are next to Kong Bilirama. Bilirama is recognized. Kong?
Opo, may nag-text po sa akin na tinatanong kung shadow government ay pwede nga gawing advisory government dahil yung shadow government parang nakakatakot, no? And let's face it, marami sa atin yung middle forces na peaceful in nature. Mga Pilipino, ganyan, kaya tayo natatagi. Masyado tayong mabait, no? So, ang inaano nila, yung shadow government, parang masyadong intriguing. Baka pwedeng palitan yung word shadow, like advisory government using the parliamentary the congressional system in discussion. No, tuli yung ganito kaya lang. Well, proposal lang yun, no? Pinapaabot ko lang sa inyo dahil kate-text lang sa akin. Mukhang nanonood. Yun lang po. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Kong Bilirama. Sana you are recognized.
Yeah, Mr. Speaker. Marinig niyo ako?
Okay.
Yes, I agree with the congressman. But maybe another term could be nearest to it, which is transition government, still, of course, under President Duterte. And then we now collaborate with the need of Professor Misuari. And I will volunteer to join the captain through the back door. Since I am also from Basilan. Wag na akong i-quarantine. I will join him kung pwede makabalik ka sa Manila, makapag-usap lang. And I will just be a witness to that. So I will join. I will volunteer.
Okay, thank you very much, Sunny. You will not be a witness. You will be one of our presenter ng ating shadow government or i-reward na natin ito, Brother Bien, base sa suggestion ni Congressman Mili. Maganda naman para kasi nga yung shadow medyo iba yung dating rin at saka yung pagbasa at saka sa pandinig. Go ahead,
yes,
Brother
Ben. Okay. Para sabi ko,
dali, Carlo. Sabi ko na nga, Siado, pag umalis na yung araw, umalis na ang ilaw, ni Siado mo nga, iwanan ka na ng Siado mo. Okay, Carlo, you're recognized.
I may ask them, Brother. I may ask them, Brother Aldo. If you will join, if one of you will join the meeting on September 4. What will be your proposed suggestion for this? I'm directing my question to Al Santillan for this.
September 4?
Yeah, yeah.
Proposal?
Yes, yes.
Hmm. In what line, brother?
In the meeting.
Mag-usap kay Norm Misuari.
Well, ako. Sige po, pasensya na po, naka-off yung video ko ah. Sobrang ano lang, madilim pa yung magulo. But I would just like, very simple po ang aking mensahe. Unity and peace. Yun po yung only way we can achieve freedom. Unity and peace. Yun lang po.
Okay, and I do believe, because Captain Ray will be there, so I do believe that what are being discussed and what is in our mind was also inside the mind of Captain Ray. I really appreciate that.
Salamat, Carlo. Salamat.
Professor Hill, if you're still around, can you say something? Although, sabi mo, meeting kayo dyan, pero baka nandyan ka, mapakinggan namin ang boses mo. And we are almost 12:34. And anything, any suggestion from the group? As far as the resolution, the meeting for Norm Misuari, the all things which are being discussed, can anybody comment, suggest, or recommend something? So if there is none,
there is suggest na po. There is suggest na po.
Go ahead, Carlo.
Siguro Captain Ray, pakipasa lang sa amin yung link at para pwede may live to sa GMTV yung meeting with Norm Misuari.
Oh, i-live na yun. Alam na ni Captain. Kapitan sa barko, kung ano pa na i-step ng misman, alam na ng kapitan yun. Or, kung wala nang mga comment or suggestion, so it is now time to suspend the session. But if you have something na ipalagdag pa ninyo, okay, I will give you 5 minutes. Kapre, one more conclusion.
Salamat sa inyo ni Brother Hill, Brother Bien at sa mga nandito. Maraming salamat sa walang sawa natin na paghahanap ng solusyon na kagaya sinabi ni Brother Noel nga is kahit yung mga Muslim brothers natin, yun rin ang gusto nila na maiwasan yung bloodshed, maiwasan yung kaguluhan. At palagay ko dahil nasa edad na rin si Chairman Noor, marami na rin siyang dinaan ng pagsubok, mga gera. At ganun rin si President Duterte, na maaring may pumipigil sa kanyang mga kamay para gawin ang lahat ng makakabuti para sa ating sambayan ng Pilipino at sa bansa natin. So that is the time, dahil lagi naman nag-uusap yung dalawa, napaka-importanting makaharap talaga natin si Chairman Noor. At makita natin ng mas malawakan yung perspektibo na maaring hindi natin nakikita dahil nga galing lang sa third party o second party yung mga information na nakakalap natin at hindi mismo galing sa kanya. So baka yun ang maging link rin ng ating grupo para iharap tayo ni Chairman Noor kay President Duterte. Who knows? Only God knows. Only Allah knows. So, okay. Yan lang ating pagdadasal, Brother Ben. Salamat.
So, sayang na hindi nakarating si Dr. Albani, Sharif Albani. Siya ay pamangkin ni Normie Suare. So, sabi niya sa akin gabi, baka alas 10 na siya makarating, pero siguro may importanteng bagay kasi siya ang presidente ng World Philosophical Forum. Siguro may mga importanteng bagay na in priority, so hindi siya nakarating ngayon. Anyhow,
dahil
napag-usapan na, so Kapre, ikaw
na bahala yung pagdating
sa Mindanao.
Yeah. Okay, walang problema. Kasama ko naman si Sir Sunny.
Okay, go ahead.
Last comment ko. Ako po'y pinanganak sa Basilan. Lumaki ako na parang Muslim. Ako'y Kristiyano ngayon at sa Luzon na nakatira. Pero mula pa noon, nakita ko na kung saan talaga ang problema. This is now the golden moment for us to have unity and peace in Mindanao. Malaking potential ng Mindanao sa agriculture. Kaya po ako ay 80 years old. Siguro kaya ako hindi mamatay dahil hindi ko nakikita ang unity with our Muslim brothers. Sana ito na ang last chance na natin ito. Pareho lang kami ng age ni Chairman Misuari. I was farming and he was teaching. I was revolutionizing my own way by revolutionizing the countryside and with rural development. He was also doing the same thing, but with armament. My armament was my writings and everything. And I would like really that this issue now on federalism, republicanism, or what's the other one? Federalism and republicanism and the Muslim peace and prosperity would now be resolved between President Duterte and Chairman, and with our help as a group on proposing a transition government, although parang shadow government tayo dito, dahil para malaman nila na if nothing happens, then the shadow will come to the light and the light will set us free. Thank you.
Okay. Closing word from Mami Pena Valdez or Angel Arian. We haven't heard your words. John Mark Insag and Maricel Quinto. Can you give any closing word before we end? So if not, around 12:39, decision suspended. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ang puloy anan, dito matay. sa kalawasan. Walay ulan, walay habol, walay banig. Pagkatulog, giunan pa ang sundan. Avancing, makalilisan. Alerta, katipunan. Ang tusol, ang kalisdanan. Tugalan nato ang kaisok. Bisag mamatay pa sa panggubatan. Tumong natong idusok. Nasutupson, bugupayon. Dali na kita pagkikisok. Abansin, makalilisan. Alerta katipunan sa bukid ang puluhanan. Dito matagampawan nakakoy sa kalawasan. Walay ulan, walay hawon, walay panin. Katulog giunlan pa ang sunda. Alerta, katipunan, abansin, makalilisan. Alerta.